on beyond 2,000 plus, whatever, whatever, whatever.
Ooh, it's E3 time. It's E3 time. Who's ready for E3 time? I'm ready for E3 time. Or at least in 6 minutes and 55 seconds, I'll be ready for E3 time. So, as you can see below, there are the drinking rules. Hopefully they're easy to see. But every time you hear world premiere, I might skip that one down to a half shot, because I know Jeff loves his world premieres, and I do too, so it all works out. Number two, anytime there's a phrase that's like these blank times, and the blank can be anything, these uncertain times, these volatile times, these unknown times, these difficult times, it seems like the kind of phrase that's not going to come up very much. Like, who's going to say that back to back, right? But somebody's going to say it eventually. And then the third one is some segment about social issues of any kind. So it's basically like a sizzle reel or a protracted segment that's not really about video games at all. It's just kind of like, I'm just imagining like long panning shots of, a rainbow of diversity of developers all huddled over art tables, scribbling out concept art. So we'll see. We'll see how this goes. I might have to dial some of these back. I don't know how common that would be. Oh, the social issues one? There's probably going to be at least one in every conference. Maybe not some of the other ones, but... So that's the idea. We'll see how it lands. What about a diversity video about how a studio is inclusive? That also counts. If it's not about a video game. And yeah, it's a sizzle reel about diversity at a studio or something like that. That absolutely counts. Basically, just has to be a segment that's not about a video game. And either... either overtly or subvertly is, you know, they're actually like bragging about diversity or something like that. It's not a bad thing, all right? None of these rules are like trying to shame anything that happens. It's more like just trying to identify the things that make the particular E3 of a given year that E3. Hey, and to me, these are the things that are going to probably identify 2021. Okay. Video about how they're cutting down on crunch? That also counts if it's not about a game. If it is about a game, and then somebody says, we're trying to make this, you know, avoiding crunch, well, it's still about a game. It's not actually about the social issues, so that's the idea. Yeah, the themes of the year. Exactly. Straight liner. Drinking orange juice, yes. Feel free to drink orange juice. No one, under any circumstance, should feel compelled to match my drinking or follow these rules 100%, because I probably won't either. We'll see. But it's way too goddamn early to get shit-faced, and also I have... Oops, my shot counter. I was just testing it. I also have work to do after this, so that'll be fun. We gotta record Inside Games today. And yeah, I'm just thinking about a... Exactly, I'm thinking about a BioWare sizzle reel where they, again, have no game to show. That one might be a little shamey. But let's back it off. Also, I'll probably just do one at the start of every conference. Just to get it going. Oh, thank you guys for the hype train, though. I appreciate that. Father Ange, thank you for the resub.
Look,
got water queued
up.
Planning to be 100% hydrated at the end of all
of this. My leg's broken.
Yes, you should be.
So you better go on without
speaking
me.
Of hydration.
Get yourself out of here while you
do
still
I hear
can.
The panther of hydration on the horizon? Perhaps I do. That's right. Today, G Fuel is 30% off with my promo code, and I realize I got to change my sponsored messages about that, or my bot messages. So much to do. So much to do. Little odds and ends here and there. Bang. There we go. Oh yeah, if you guys are needing your G Fuel, now's a perfect time to stock up, because you will pay less money than ever before.
You aren't scared, are you?
Chris, thank you for the cheer. G Fuel, is that the one hamster movie? Yep, it's a good one. It's a good one. But yeah, aside from their energy mix, they also make a hydration mix that doesn't really have any caffeine. And it's got like, it's basically like Pedialyte, but in powder form. So you can mix it up whenever you want. And that also makes it an excellent pairing when you drink a lot. Because I am discovering the value of hydration when it comes to getting into one's cups. It has saved me a lot of pain. Literally. I get bad headaches if I don't drink enough water. Tried the new Tetris flavor. Not yet. I need to ask for that. Get my guy to hook me up. Yeah, it's got electrolytes. Plants crave that. You don't like Pedialyte, Curly Peak? I like it. I don't mind it. Maybe I could see having bad associations with it. Where are the rules posted? They are right there. So hopefully that's easy enough. Mystic, thanks for the sub. Joker, thank you for the resub. Nintendo, oh yeah, 64 months. Nice. Can we have a rule for a cyberpunk apology? I don't think we're going to get many of those. I mean, CDPR doesn't have a conference. So who would be apologizing? Vince, thank you for gifting a sub. Waiting on four tubs? Nice. Which flavor should I try first? Tokarine. That's a great name. It depends. I mean, it depends what you're... like, what kind of flavors you like. Which is a dumb... kind of a dumb, cagey answer, but... what about... it's been a challenging year. See, I wanted to do any reference to COVID, but I think that's too much. That's a good question. Well, we'll see how I feel when I get there. Yeah, Chris, I agree. Watermelon is a really good flavor. And also, yeah, the starter kit comes with a variety of flavors, so you can try them all out. For 30% off. But yes, we really need these Poggers times. These PogChamp times. These incredibly lit times. Gabion, thank you for the resub. Shot when somebody says pandemic. I mean, if you want to, I don't think people are going to say that. People like to dance around it, you know? Why remind people of uncomfortable things? Just make a slight reference to it. Ooh. This is a really bad idea. I'm sipping on a flavorful cappuccino before I slam myself with alcohol. This is going to be a hell of a conference.
A gut destroyer. All right.
We're coming up. I'm going to take my first shot of the day. Work from home or remote working? Oh, those would be good. Those would be good, but... all right. All right, Jeff, let's do it. Show me the premieres, baby. All right. To E3 2021. It's back, baby. Or I guess this technically isn't E3, but whatever. Just got his own thing.
I told you we'd start right on time. Hello, everyone around the world, and welcome to Summer Game Fest Kickoff Live. Presented by Prime Gaming. I'm Jeff.
The first one's always the worst.
Buckle up, because we've got eight.
Let me see them kicks, Jeff. Filled with new game announcements. Oh, look at this! He's got like some light pink, and then he had pink shoes.
Some surprises.
My guy's ensembles always on point.
Giancarlo Esposito and performances by Weezer, Japanese Breakfast, and the Sonic the Hedgehog Symphony Orchestra. Yes, that's really a thing. Now, like video game, some twists along the way today. And just wait until you see what we have planned for the end game. That is all I'm allowed to tell you right now.
Ooh, this is just the Elden Ring. It's the Elden Ring. That's what he means. He must mean it. He must.
Events from publishers like Xbox and Bethesda, Square
Enix, Ubisoft,
and more. Head right now to summergamefest.com to track all the events. And believe me, there is a lot of great stuff coming your way. But today, we kick things off with a big 90-minute cross-industry showcase meant to put platforms and rivalries aside. We have updates and news for you.
Mr. Carl Hungus, thank you for the Prime.
PC, PlayStation, or Xbox. The biggest games in the world will be here, and some of the smallest ones, too.
Yeah.
Made by emerging voices and developers.
The ones that paid for featuring.
Who represent.
Can't wait to see these games.
So much.
You think Blanco's Block Party is going to show up?
Video games.
They seem to have a ton of, like, investment capital. They spend it in weird ways.
Brand new game announcement. You're about to see the world premiere of the next great adventure from Gearbox and 2K.
World premiere. Is Gearbox doing a new IP? Please, God. World premiere. So this one might be a half because there's going to be a lot of world premieres. I feel like Jeff loves that shit. So I'm gonna go early and say world premiere. I'm gonna take a full one this time, but you guys don't have to. I mean, clearly you don't.
It rises from the grave.
Wonderlands? That's actually a really good name. That's a fucking great name if that's what it ends up being. Did they show that already? They didn't, right? King Sora, thank you for the Prime. It's a Dagrin. Well, yeah.
Make your own.
Oh boy. All right. Yep. It's a fantasy Borderlands. Anyway, world premiere. Oh, boy. Oh, boy. Oh, man. So they're already priming this to be like a show then. Because they're in a movie deal. I thought we were over sparkle unicorns and butt stallions. This is like very 2010s internet humor. I guess that's Gearbox. Yep, it shot a rainbow out of its unicorn. All right. Yeah, okay. That's a great name. That's a great name. Fucking Christ. All right, that's a great game I will never play. Cheers. Or a great name of a game I will never play. Cheers. World premiere.
Tiny Tina's Wonderlands is official.
Ashley Birch.
Now is Tiny Tina herself, Ashley Birch. Hey, Ash, how you
What's
doing?
What's up, baby? How you doing?
Ashley is a pure soul. The big question we don't deserve her.
What is Wonderlands? What can you tell us about it?
It's a great question.
I mean, it's pretty self-explanatory,
it's a
right?
It's a take on a looter shooter, as you saw. And if you're a fan of Borderlands, you'll probably
Randy Pitchford is a hack? Come
some
on.
Fantasy elements inspired by...
He may not make games you like, but... Oh, yeah, Shot Counter. Thank you.
...was beloved by the devs, and so this kind of inspired Wonderlands.
Now, I think the elephant in the room is this a Borderlands game? Is it not? How does it relate?
So it actually isn't. It's its own standalone game.
But Tiny Tina is a... whatever.
People that love Borderlands are going to find lots of elements to love about Wonderlands, but it's its own thing. Tiny Tina's got her own thing going on now. So it's got its own mechanics. There's spell casting. You can customize your character this time, which is super exciting.
Well, you could put on skins and stuff.
So
maybe that doesn't count as customizing.
You're going to find stuff to love in this. And if you've never played a Borderlands game, this is a great place to start.
Okay, so you're telling me everyone can play it.
Her own game, which is fantastic. Yes. What is her role? Why does she get her own game?
So she is your bunker master. She is kind of guiding the narrative and changing it on a dime if she wants. And she's just taking your cast.
I love this time of year so much. Me too. Cast,
through this wacky world.
So good.
And she's taking you on an adventure to defeat the Dragon Lord. And who is that? I don't know. You'll have to play.
And I wonder.
I mean, I think it's that guy. Is it that guy? Is it the guy on the cover? Is that the Dragon Lord?
Feels like
maybe not. Maybe the Dragon Lord is a dude who calls you on the phone every time you turn in a quest and like monsters you a little bit.
Hopefully.
And he's like kind of kooky and crazy, and he says funny jokes, and sometimes some things are going on in the background. And sometimes he screams real loud, and it's very funny.
But yeah, just stay tuned for updates.
All right, coming early 2022. So
yes.
Look forward to next year. Ash, thank you.
Wait, there's a robot? I thought you said it was fantasy. Wait, I guess it doesn't matter. Whatever. If it sells, put it in. People love robots. People love Dungeons and Dragons.
This one you probably are not expecting. A classic 90s franchise is coming back to life as a grid-based tactical strategy title for Steam on PC.
Which 90s franchises are left?
Trailer. I hope you'll enjoy it.
Oh no, they're gonna get me. The nostalgia, I'm too old. Conker's back, yeah. Oh, that's, Wild Arms? I know that font. All right, that's actually a pretty cool idea. An SNK? Oh, it's fucking Metal Slug, never mind. Yeah, it's Metal Slug. Oh, that music! He didn't say world premiere, though. That's kind of sucks. Wow. I did not expect a new Metal Slug title. Oh my gosh, those sound effects. I mean, this music, can you... This is not, like, typical tactical game music. Although, that's a great adaptation for the Metal Slug franchise. There's just so many orchestra hits. That's the sound of the 90s, the synthesized orchestra hit. Yeah, what if war were anime and rad as hell? Although that's not even really what Metal Slug is about at some point. I think after Metal Slug 2, it's mostly about aliens. Shirtless dudes standing out of tanks. Can we get a little more volume? Yes, of course. I was turning the wrong knob. I gotta wait for there to be audio.
We have another big announcement for you from a surprise guest, but it's well past 3 a.m. their time. So don't worry, we chatted earlier, and I'm very excited to share this with you right now. Hello, mystery guest.
Oh, it's best buddy, Hideo Kojima.
Mr. Kojima, it is so good to see you.
Oh, thank look at Jeff lighting up.
From Tokyo.
Imagine.
First of all, I just want to ask, how are you
imagine
doing?
Being
how
Jeff Keighley and bathing in the light of Kojima.
Over there in Japan.
Washing over you. Kojima should be a shot. It should have been. Hey, if you guys want to take a shooter for Kojima, I'm gonna throw this out there. I don't think Kojima drinks. If he does, he takes like contemplative sips of a very fine sake or like a really good highball or something like that.
Creator, how has this past year impacted you?
How drunk am I right now? You can tell from the shots. I'm only taking two shots, so I'm not that bad. Kojima parties down. He probably used to, but he's older. He's more sentimental now. Look at that salt and pepper beard. Yeah, he only drinks one on the top of mountains at sunset.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, you're making a dumb fun game now, Koji?
Mm.
Did he just admit that Death Stranding isn't fun? I mean, maybe. I don't think Death Stranding was really made to be fun. Maybe made to be introspective and calming. That's kind of how I think about it. And it, the game parts of it were fun for me, but it wasn't produced to be pure fun. There's a big difference between what Death Stranding did in terms of not being a fun game and what Last of Us did in terms of not being a fun game.
I don't know how much you can say, but can you give us any sense of
talking about 9/11 has to count for these blank times? I mean, that wasn't these times. 9/11 was those times. So it is a bit of a difference. But I mean, talking about Death Stranding and talking about quarantine, that is almost these times, but it's not that phrase, unfortunately. You did say COVID? It's not the rule, though. Don't be in a rush, you guys. Don't be in a rush. I understand wanting to get as drunk as quickly as possible, but we got a whole conference in front of us. This could be a segment about social issues, though. Because he's talking entirely about social issues, and it's not specifically about a game. I think it does qualify for the third rule.
All right.
Kojima rethinking his creative process comes off as a very important thing for him. Absolutely.
Kojima, honestly, I really do appreciate
that's a shocking level of transparency.
Say hello to everyone. We miss you, and we can't wait to see what you're working on next. So thank you.
Jeff. Oh, one more thing.
Oh! Kojima! No way. Is he going to world premiere us? Oh, okay. PS5 port of Death Stranding. There's gonna be some goofy suits. Oh, is he going to Shadow Moses? Sam Porter Bridges and Samuel Snake teamed up together at last. Iroquois Plissken Snake. Oh my god, it's a fucking Metal Gear style. That's a Metal Gear level. That's awesome. You're gonna have to like crawl and crouch behind things. Oh, that's so good. Sam, we've got a new mission for you. Even this music is so like Metal Gear. It's like the exact same camera angles too. Come on, you gotta. There was a codec in fucking Death Stranding. First person vent crawling. Think the bunkers spell out something? That is potentially likely. Box! He gonna put our box! Alright, well, I think that counts as a segment about social issues, even though it's not quite what I thought it would be. So I'm definitely going to shoot up for that. Oranges is a reference to something. I don't remember what off the top of my head, though. Wait, because the cardboard box in Metal Gear Solid said orange on it, right? So they're just trying their best to reference. Yeah, it's a Metal Gear Solid 2, that's it. It just said, like, orange on it, or the orange. What's up, Cyber Ham Sandwich? Okay, now you're in a box. Oh, Kojima has fun, doesn't he? So Sam is basically a cat. Anyway. Yeah. This is sick content. That's three. Danny. Oh, he puts it back. Didn't quite work out, did it? Get as close to the Solid theme as you can without getting sued by Konami. Oh! Now that... calling it a director's cut actually fascinates me. Because if it's going to have, like, additional content and commentary from Kojima or the rest of the design staff, that's what I'm super into. If it has that stuff.
There you have it. Death Stranding director's
cut. Again, look at this. Look at the color coordination.
Confirmed. I hope
outrageous.
I make it into the director's cut. I'm told
you
the
have
full
to.
Reveal is just weeks away. Stay tuned. All right, next. It's my honor to welcome to Summer Game Fest a legendary actor who dedicated a whole episode of his Disney Plus show to exploring the world of gaming and has been in games like Call of Duty Black Ops 3. And we're thrilled to
Chris
have
Maloney?
Him here at Summer Game Fest.
Chris Maloney?
Jeff Goldblum, oh. How are you, my friend?
Oh, my gosh.
Thank you so much, Geoff, or... I think it's Jeffrey. Hey, maybe it's Jeff. Hi, Jeff. Thank you so much, sincerely, for having me here. I'm thrilled to be here. Hey, I was watching your show, and I was
he looks
wondering,
like an elf.
If there might be some video game world premieres. And sure enough, yeah, there is.
How much is a
yes,
how much
like
is Jeff Goldblum playing Jeff Goldblum these days?
Well, it's funny you should say that. Yes.
Well, it seems say, we
yes, I do. If
we have a game to show you, a video game.
There's a little bit of a teleprompter.
Indeed.
So I'm going to read something.
I'm going to guess the like
I'm very meticulous about this. So
the show notes have been like be as Jeff Goldblum as you can be.
Game announcement. Like, okay, ready? Right. I'm going to make the so game announcement right now.
Here we go.
Hello. I'm here to welcome you to a very different world.
Oh my.
It's going to elevate you to new heights. It's going to submerge you to new depths.
Mm.
Maybe even challenge you to control chaos.
Mm.
Actually, it's going to certainly challenge you to control chaos. It's a world
premiere,
so-called evolved.
Mm.
Take a look at the... you guessed it.
See Brad.
World premiere.
I already took a shot with that, Jeff. Excuse me. See Brad, thank you for the resub. Shadow the Hedgehog 2, you called it, Malcolm. Oh, Malcolm, by the way, your card finally bounced back to me. Oh, it's a Jurassic Park game. Are you fucking for real? Man, come on.
Forgot the lessons.
Boy. All right. Well, I'm going to go get another bottle of vodka because I've already blown out the one I have. So one second.
We played with genetics like it was a toy. We weren't careful. And now, here we are.
World premiere. What did you expect, the Fly game? I guess I hoped it would be a new IP.
Different world.
Why is Jurassic Park a brand? Why is it a property? I guess people like dinosaurs, but... it's had more bad movies than good. So I don't get it. Which is to say, it's largely been bad. Anyway, cool. That's cool for
right,
people, I guess.
This performer's new album, Jubilee, is out now, and her book, Crying in H Mart, is a New York Times bestseller.
What?
Here now to perform Glider from the upcoming open what? World game Sable by Raw Fury and Shedworks, it's Japanese Breakfast.
Oh, okay. I'm going to be real, like, Japanese breakfast is not super hot. I had a lot of great food in Japan, but breakfast is not one of the meals they do. Fish and rice for breakfast. I was, after like a week there, I was just fiending for some eggs and bacon. Really hard to get. She's Korean-American, so don't worry about it. All right. Base is covered, then. Please, breakfast time. We went to Denny's in Japan for breakfast. It's owned by 7-Eleven. Pretty good. Yeah, that's probably the only place you could get, like, an American diner breakfast. Oh, this game. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I was looking forward to this. This looked really cool. Let's cel shade everything like it's the 2010s, baby. Actually, that was more of a mid-aughts play. This song sounds like how this game looks, yeah. I mean, Death Stranding vibes, right? You're plodding around in a big empty wasteland, a ponderous shoegaze music. What's the game? Sable. Looks cool. It does. I have no idea what the game is. You know, obviously it seems very exploration-based. I play this high. Icy Cucumber, I was just thinking that exact thing. Seems like a fun fuck-around game. One of those games where you can't really do anything wrong. Oh, that's cool. They've got, like, projections going on the floor. I remember Jeff's soundstage looking a little choppy for the last... It wasn't a Game Awards thing. I can't remember what it was. It was some random event. But it is gone. It is like... It's wild how much better it is. That's a good-ass production team. Nice, weird transition, though. Jeff likes to put on multi-sensory entertainment experiences.
So beautiful. Thank you, Michelle. Sable will be released on September 23rd this year. That's
also
the news for you.
Jeff is looking lean as hell.
This amazing game. Watch the Tribeca Game Showcase. That is tomorrow. Where
my guy was hitting the
named an official selection of the legendary
hitting the treadmill hard.
Now, today is just the start.
Wearing
of
like a sweatsuit and a sauna.
With IM 8-Bit and Double Fine, will immediately follow the live show.
Yeah, he's
today.
Trim as fuck.
There are more events coming all weekend and all month, including the Xbox and Bethesda Games Showcase on Sunday. It's going to be a good one. Right now, though, we're thrilled to announce the upcoming Western release of a spectacular 3D massively multiplayer online role-playing game. Welcome to the world of Lost Ark from Smilegate RPG and Amazon Games.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there it is. This is the game that paid to be in the show. Well, I guess maybe they all did, but... Amazon will launch an MMO one of these days, I'm sure of it.
A Lost Ark is now but a myth. A relic from the half-remembered Chain War.
Have you ever met Jeff in person? Yes.
Now,
very briefly.
The world has been torn once again.
We exchanged a few words, I think, after E3 2019?
Have returned.
Yeah.
With roaring destruction and waking.
Wasn't Jeff on Dude Soup once? Oh, yes! There's also that. Yeah, through Elise, I think, we got Jeff to be on Dude Soup. And he was like, an amazing guest. Super engaging, like... it's like, it's one thing to be a good host, and I think when you've hosted a lot, you understand what a host wants from somebody who's on or like a guest. And he was 100% that. Like, he was there, he was fun, he was bought into everything, he engaged in every conversation. By all accounts, Jeff is genuinely a great dude. Well, you know, I have theories about that. I don't think you get to be where Jeff is without being a little cutting. I think he's a pretty relentless businessman. That would be my guess. You probably wouldn't want to try to make another gaming awards show, because I think he would crush your ass. That's my theory. But apart from that, well, let's be real. We don't know anything about him, but he's put together a lot of great shows that I've enjoyed. So I got no qualms there. His public persona is clean as fuck. Yeah, he's been very good about that. He's groomed his public image impeccably. And that's not something everyone can do.
Sometimes when you play a game, there's that one thing in your inventory which turned out to be far more useful than you first realized. That's kind of like Prime Gaming. If you're an Amazon Prime member, and most of you probably are,
okay,
you get a ton of gaming goodies every month. This month, you can download...
Jeff, you don't get to cash that check for free, huh?
The Telltale series.
Yeah, you got to hashtag out a little bit on the tail end, huh?
And there are special in-game benefits and perks in GTA Online, Valorant, Apex Legends, and...
It's just so weird to remember when, like, Dorito
awesome
Pope
value, and honestly,
shit was going around and everyone thought that Jeff was the herald of
for a new way to bring you the news this
of
summer.
Big corporate money,
so,
you know? Which he was, but turns out that's not that bad.
Games, which change every month, but you get to keep them forever.
Huh. If I used to have sizzle reels as a drinking rule, and then that year there just were no sizzle reels, so. But, you know, this is a sizzle. Doesn't count though. I have my origin banned forever.
Okay, right now I'm honored to be joined by Johanna Ferris, the new GM of Call of Duty.
What is with these eyeballs?
It's so great to have you with us here on Kickoff.
It's like
Live.
It's close
Everyone's
to a like a face Call that would be on a tile for a mobile game, except there's no teeth.
Looks like next week, June 17th.
Wait, which direction
four?
Do you look? I think it's this way.
We're super excited. We're super honored to be here. So thank you for
a little tongue poking
that.
Out.
It's just such an amazing time for Call of Duty. We're experiencing such transformational growth and dynamism across the entire brand, you know, from premium title releases to everything we'll talk about today, with Warzone, with mobile, with esports. So it's just super incredible.
So she's on like stage mics?
Shout out to the Call of Duty family who makes it happen every day.
Yeah, no, you've been, I mean, I know season three, it was like, you know, Rambo.
Sounds like they boom mic'd her. They didn't like give her a lob or lapel or anything.
Continually update the game now with new stuff. Season four is coming next week. What can you, this is first info on it, so what can you tell the fans watching around the world?
Yeah, we're stoked. It's jam-packed.
Maybe Jeff likes holding a mic.
Across Cold
I mean,
War,
there's a lot of value to the host having a mic.
New weapons.
It's like holding the conch
maps.
Shell.
We've got badass new operators. I'm super excited about the hijacked gulag. We've got expanded zombies content for everybody who loves that part of, you know, the gameplay experience. So we're thrilled.
No technical difficulties drinking rule?
A little bit here
Wait.
Today.
Who do you think we're watching here? This is Jeff motherfucking Keighley. You think he's gonna have a single tech problem in this entire show? Give me a break. I think we're dealing with amateurs here. Yeah, the mic gives Jeff power. It's his Samson hair. Take his mic away and he shrivels into a small slug. Again, the eyes.
Secure the site.
So I guess they have villains now, right? War just turned hot. You gotta play this multiplayer game to shoot this masked man with his crazy villain eyes. Did you take a shot for the last Game World premiere? Yeah, I think so. It was Jurassic Park. Evolution 2.
Located the satellite.
Damn it, this would be another sizzle. Oh well. Actually, no wait, it's only for one game. It doesn't count. There's a dragon now, and a zombie thing. His eyes seem too close together. Sure.
Oh my god, that looks so fun, and 1 week away.
1 week away?
All right, well, let's move on to, you first joined Activision.
We only wait 7 days for Zombie Dragons to shoot with tactical guns.
What is the World Series of Warzone, which is going to start on June the
Video games are so fucking cool.
First of all, tell us, what is World Series of Warzone?
Yeah, video games are so fucking cool.
It's really a new way.
True Dat, thank you for the sub. I am pretty stoked for 2042.
We've got great success going with Call of Duty.
I love Battlefield. And every time a Battlefield game comes out, I get to play Battlefield for like 3 weeks, and then everyone else just sort of scatters to the winds. So I'm looking forward to 3 weeks of Battlefield.
We'll talk a little bit about
Aspiring Warlock. Thank you for the resub.
Lobby experiences, 150.
Oh, it said world premiere. Shit.
Squad. So
did somebody say? Well, kind of rally. I guess I wasn't very clear on that. Wait, where was the world premiere?
June 22nd.
That I missed.
Looks like Twitch Rivals is going to be a part of this.
Yeah, we are honored to be in partnership with.
I wish
Twitch
it was 2142.
Always, right?
2142 is still there. If you can find people to play it with.
Rivals, who's
I was on the bump
so
at the end.
Much.
Ah, okay, I missed that. All right.
Put
you know what? It counts.
On display, so
I did play 2142 back in the day. I don't know that it was awesome though. It was slow.
Yes, there is one.
It was so slow. Tribes was faster than 2142. And to me, 2142 was like the closest game to Tribes that came out back then.
At least for the first.
Captain Swag. That name rules.
Getting a little bit reveal here.
The 2142 was slow as shit.
Yeah, we love the first five captains of the first of many events to come. Like I said,
oh, Snubs, thanks for gifting a sub.
And personalities in Call
they
of
said
Duty.
World, not series, not premiere. Oh,
right?
Well,
we really believe
then it doesn't count,
the
guys.
Of series of Warzone, gosh, you guys. And to really level up what it means to really battle.
What's
it
up, Austin?
So, couldn't be happier with some of these names, many of whom also hail
the
Call of Duty League family. And I'm excited to see who kind of takes the cake here. We'll see.
I was going to say, they're all be battling out.
What's up, man?
Just a couple weeks on.
Once you get to 100, you need to throw
really
me a party?
Exciting,
that seems fair.
See how much
you
know, Call of Duty is growing into this kind of year-round experience for everyone with so much more content. So we can't wait to see where you're going to take it. And I know there is a big new mainline game.
Suburban Samurai, too, right? Thanks for the Prime.
Indeed.
Oh, that's right.
More
okay.
Details to share later.
Definitely a COD coming this year. I can't remember.
You know, bring forward
I was like
really
theorizing that this may not be a Call of Duty year, right, but it totally is. So I don't know what.
There will come a time.
So yeah, it's.
Thank you so much for joining us. We really appreciate it.
All right, I guess it's going to be Battlefield versus COD again.
To go. But right now, we've got a surprise guest joining us, my fellow Canadian.
Is it Kojima again?
Ryan Reynolds. Hey, Ryan.
Well, thank you, Jeff. And hello, Summer Game Fest. Now, I know what you're thinking. And no, I'm not here to announce I'm the star of Elden Ring. I think. Instead, no, I'm here to talk about.
I like that pause for the audience pop.
Things? Of course you don't. Look, I have a new movie coming out August 13th called Free Guy. And in this movie, I play an NPC character in a popular open world video game until I break free and I realize that it kind of sucks to be
Elden
a lonely background character on an endless walk cycle. Man. So now
we need to do a combination. Devolver, are you listening? If anyone from Devolver is listening, hit me up about this because I'm not joking. A combination pro wrestling game reveal event.
I didn't say that.
Because, okay, so you imagine two guys getting a slobber knocker, somebody gets pinned, and then the winner gets on the mic and says, can I hear Elden Ring? Get the audience popping a little bit and like, okay, bring it down a bit. We got an indie game to talk about now.
What are these, trick glasses or something?
I'm training.
There is no easy way to say this.
I'm in that ring. I'm taking my bumps.
It's a video game. You're not real. Please, that mother... And the guy responsible for this world is going to destroy.
Anyway, no game publisher
God?
Has had God? The yes, audacity to announce a game after landing an amazing suplex.
But we have to fight together.
That'd be the 2010 Konami presentation. Well, it's memorable, isn't it?
That actually hurt my hand.
I have three words for you. Blue shirt guy.
This guy is outskilling all these players. I've never seen anything like this.
Who the hell even knows who this blue shirt guy is?
He's also really
cool.
The game wasn't even made for someone like this.
This feels like a movie Rooster Teeth should have tried to make. But it didn't have the budget.
Nope. I can't die! I'm never gonna die!
I just wish my movies had more influencers in them.
Seeing Ninja, Pokey, Jacksepticeye, Laserbeam, all those guys who will be in Free Guy.
Was that fun?
Ryan,
I don't know if that was fun.
I can't say it yet.
Maybe that was fun.
Up next, it won multiple awards at the Game Awards, and Among Us just keeps going. Now it's time to hear from Inner Sloth,
on what's coming next.
Oh yeah, I filled out their little form to get the Jeff mask. I don't know if that got turned on or not. Maybe not. Maybe Jeff's blackballing me. Maybe he's afraid of me. He doesn't want me getting his mask. Cheeky secret peek. Thank you for the prime and a rose. Thank you for the resub. Oh, so they're basically putting like Town of Salem stuff into the game. That makes sense. Oh no. Do not add achievements to Among Us. Oh no. Neat.
Lots of fun ahead.
Content.
Last year, you may remember the very rare Jeff Keighley mask was available as a Twitch drop around the Game Awards, never to be seen again.
Gamer McGee, thank you for the prime.
People who get booted from games with the mask because folks think that they're hacked. Well, never fear. Today, the mask is back. Just head to Twitch, connect your account, and watch 15 minutes or more of Kickoff Live to get your very own Jeff Keighley mask once again, and then it goes back into the vault. I don't know what's going on. All right. Speaking of independent developers, now I'm very happy to welcome to Summer Game Fest the head of indies at PlayStation, a legend in his own right who has some exciting things to share, Shuhei Yoshida.
Oh,
hi, Shu.
Shuhei.
Thanks, Jeff. Hi, everyone.
You want to talk about a real pillar of light?
The PlayStation indies.
Shuhei Yoshida
is... What I love about working with independent
impossibly pure.
Are the new and unexpected games that they create, which allows us to offer an array of unique experiences.
Stealthsoft, thank you for the resub. Or sorry, thank you for the gift.
In my role as Sony, it's very exciting to get to meet with these talented studios, which sometimes can be one person or a small group of friends, to help nurture their ideas and bring them to the PlayStation fans. One example is from Finji, who has been working with Greg Lobanov, the developer of Wondersong, to publish their new game, Chicory, A Colorful Tale. Chicory released today and gives players the chance to experience a coloring book-style world where players use their painting powers to explore, solve puzzles, make friends, and draw on anything.
I like it.
Check out Chicory, A Colorful Tale on PlayStation 4 or PlayStation 5 after the show. As a huge Soulspawn game,
Final Fantasy Remake is out, my man.
Totally,
so is Ratchet and Clank.
To the action adventure Salt and Sanctuary.
You're gonna tell me I'm gonna play that instead of looking at Tifa in 4K?
Sky Studios has been hard at work on a new title, which I'm proud to present.
Oh, Sky Studios, those guys.
Salt and Sacrifice.
Sharks fan, thank you for the prime. Salt and Sacrifice? So this is a sequel to Salt and Sanctuary? Oh yeah, looks like it.
We'll catch up with us.
Neat.
Always.
I didn't finish Salt and Sanctuary, but I played it a fair amount. It was good.
I was given a second chance.
Yeah. This is the real Elden Ring here. Not my thing, but it looks cool. Yeah. It's a 2D Souls. No joking. No goofing. I don't like the 90s Flash game animation style. Yeah, they've kind of always been like that. That's been their style the whole way. Even back into like when they broke out in the thousand or the aughts. What was their first game? Samurai... something Dishwasher? Samurai Dishwasher? Oh my god.
I am a marked inquisitor.
I'm getting to the point now where I've like... I've played enough games... that I don't remember all of them 100%. I have like 60% knowledge of thousands and thousands of games. It was just called The Dishwasher? Oh, okay. The Dishwasher Dead Samurai. Okay, I knew Samurai was in the title somewhere. Well, that's neat. Also, Scott Studios rules. Just because of the name. That's fine.
Thanks, Shu, and that's not all. Today we're also...
Oh yeah, a little bit of Muramasa and Vanillaware style. It is that sort of like...
Annapurna and Heart Machine
keyframed
game,
animation.
Ash, which is coming to PlayStation later this year.
Keyframed animation style, yeah. It is pretty similar. Oh, we got some big art. We got some big art on the way. How does Annapurna do it? I don't get it. It's not easy to find this stuff. And it's not easy to sign it before anyone else does. And somehow Annapurna keeps doing it. That was one of the things that, like... I remember Rooster Teeth Games wanted to do this stuff. They wanted to, like, find these indies before anyone else did. And it turns out that that's really hard to do. To find, like, an unsigned project that's really promising from, like, a capable dev studio that hasn't already been signed to Annapurna or Devolver or any other number of indie publishers. They got Bendy, and then that was kind of it. And I wasn't part of any of that process. I was just kind of observing it from the outside because the publishing business does fascinate me. Cool. That's a neat looking logo.
That looks so, so great. Can't wait to see it later this year. Now, this week, there is a ton of video game news, but there's also a big game launching across console and PC, Chivalry 2, which brings 64-player multiplayer medieval battles to life. Sledgehammers, swords, axes,
I mean,
you name it.
That game's pretty sweet.
Torn Banner Studios,
Chivalry 2 is real fun.
Toronto, Canada.
I wasn't prepared for how stupid fun that game is.
Chivalry 2, which you can play right now.
That's the thing I've grown to understand is that, like, when games get hecka popular, there's usually a reason for it. Like, some movies get really popular because I don't know, throw it back, like Jurassic Park World or Jurassic World. Like, why is this movie doing so well? This movie's not good. But I found with most games when they, like, develop a core, when they develop a base, there's usually a reason. Medieval Scream Simulator 2. Yeah, I was leaning on that key pretty hard. Did you see James Cameron's Avatar? See, now I actually enjoyed that movie, and I understand why it was popular. I mean, it was the sort of, like, high fantasy Star Wars style movie. I didn't really feel that until Guardians of the Galaxy.
For Agatha!
Sick. Yeah, you don't go see Avatar for the compelling story. It's just a dumb, fun ride with weird, you know, colonialist overtones. Excellent. So much better than that Ubisoft game I can't remember the name of. Oh, you mean For Honor? It's
this
a different kind of game.
From Riot celebrated its one-year anniversary, and starting next Monday, June 14th, Prime Gaming members will get an exclusive player card to celebrate the one-year anniversary and a pity party spray through June 25th. This is all leading up to the release of Episode 3 of the game later this month, which will be celebrated with an epic WW Fest unlocked year one stream.
You watch
on
Fast
June
and Furious
25th.
For the family? I watch Fast and Furious for my family.
Agent. Who could it be? Well, here's your first very, very exclusive but very, very quick tease to whet your appetite with more to be revealed later this month during Summer Game Fest.
Is it Kojima? Does it count? I mean, it said world premiere, so I'm going to take a shot for that. World premiere. I couldn't tell if somebody had to, like, say it out loud or if it's just on screen. What? Are you fucking kidding me?
Very,
oh,
very
my God.
Quick.
Oh, boy. All right.
Warring PMC factions face off against each other.
Bionicles!
The popular multiplayer first
finally, Bionicles and Valorant.
By Battlestate Games. Today, we've got an exclusive.
Can't believe I'm taking a shot for Bionicle.
Tarkov, the new area of the game under development.
What? Is that too? Okay. All right. New. Okay. We're skipping world premiere down to a half. So that counts as one full shot. Oh, that's weird. Like an ice cube, like, froze to the side of the bottle. Anyway. World premieres are a half shot now. Unless it's set out loud. Set out loud, full shot. If it just cuts to that card, it's a half. Is it just Tarkov? No, it's Streets of Tarkov. Do you see the streets? Do you see them? It's not new. It said world premiere. Are you calling Jeff Keighley a liar? Are you really out here calling Jeff Keighley a liar? It cuts to the card before and after everything. No, only if it's a world premiere. Anyway, cheers. This beat is fucking fire, though. I don't know. I haven't played a single second of Streets of Tarkov, so. World of Tarkov. Tarkov Ultimate. Tarkov Director's Cut. The Tarkov. Tarkov Online. Ultimate Tarkov. Brother BD, thank you. Tarkov Kart. Tarkov World Party. Trains of Tarkov. Tarkov Simulator 2020. Tarkov 2077. This music is kind of making me think. This track is sick. I want to know what this music is, because I would listen to more of this. Look at it just be like track number 6 on an EDM sampler. We got that shit off a royalty-free music site, dude. Tarkov Adventure 2 Battle. Good stuff. Tarkov Wars. Elden Tarkov. Shadow of the Tarkov 4 White Ops. Ooh. Tarkov Soul Dance Dance Tarkov. Tarkov with a Vengeance. These are all great. There's so many at Tarkovs to play. Shin Megami Tarkov. World premiere.
When I was a kid, the simulation games of Peter Molyneux were some of my favorites. Adding that extra salt on the fries in the theme park to increase your drink sales was so devilish. Well, many of the team members behind those...
That sounds like the exact thing that Jeff would really get a kick out of.
Two-point hospital.
Well, figuring out how to squeeze some extra money out of people.
To share the first trailer for their next...
Are you telling me it's a world premiere trailer, Jeff?
Point Campus.
What? Oh!
That first sight of the school gates, the scent of a leather-bound book, the faint clatter of knights jousting.
All right, I'm taking a half seas for that. I remember that part. Peter still owes me for God Cube. You mean Goddess? You see, campus. I was actually kind of into that game.
Nowadays, education.
They only have one transition. There's got to be things that aren't world premieres, right?
And quite right too. Apparently, the results speak for themselves. Academia has never been more appealing, more dynamic, more...
Two-point university.
Today's campus is a place to live and a place to learn.
I liked tapping that cube. I liked it. I enjoyed tapping that cube. It was perfect. It was like 2 minutes, 3 minutes of cube tapping while you're squeezing out your business. You know damn well every single games event has the most world premieres in the history of games events. That's true. I was thinking about that last night when I was like... I don't consume a lot of new media because I'm already exhausted of opinion. And what really... I don't know. Not only is there more stuff being made now than ever before, but also we have access to the library of all human creation in all of media as far back as it goes. So,
class is in session 2022.
It's so hard to find the motivation to consume any new artistic output from anyone out of all of that.
This year, I am thrilled to have Netflix as a part of Summer Game Fest. They have been doing
I'm thrilled too, Jeff.
Job adapting.
You know what? I'm thrilled
like
too.
Castlevania and the Dota anime. Well, there is a lot more coming, and you don't have to wait long to find out more. Tomorrow, I'm honored to be guest hosting Netflix's Geeked Week live
with Rahul Kohli.
Rahul Kohli. The first clip of the Cuphead show.
He said the name.
Spoiler alert, this show is going to be an absolute sensation. I can't wait
for to text him.
I'll also sit down with the team behind Arcane, the League of Legends animated show coming later this year, and we might also have updates on The Witcher and the live-action Resident Evil series. Geeked Week is streaming live tomorrow at 9 a.m. Pacific, noon Eastern. Here's a little sneak peek.
What is Geeked Week? Netflix Geek is hosting a free...
It's Raul!
...full of big news, exciting first looks, and the people who make the shows and films you love on Netflix. Comics, games, movies, zombies, animation...
Love to see it. Love to see it. This is a pretty good trailer, too. I've seen a lot of trailers made in this style that aren't this good.
from the shows you love live. Grab your devices, tuck in, and join Netflix Geeked for Geeked Week.
I feel like they told Rahul to be a little more British. Like, can you dial up the British just a little bit?
We aren't done with Netflix just yet, though. Coming up next is Smite, a cross-play, cross-platform
Rahul is no longer jobless. Well, they're not paying him, but
IP crossovers.
One of these days, he'll get a paying gig.
Avatar, the Last Bender one. Well, as Smite enters its ninth
year, a rare from Jeff. A rare World premiere. It is secretly my goal one day to either have a role that I can like table read with Rahul to workshop, or he has a role that he wants to read with me to workshop. That's my goal. I feel like it must be really weird in this day and age to be like, to have a pretty prominent role in a show and then have that version of you exist digitally as you continue to grow and change and age. I mean, it was probably weird as shit to be a child actor in general, but to then have that version of you persist in other medium. All right. 80s. World premiere. That's a half seas.
Next up, we announce a lot of games on my shows, but I think this is the first time we are announcing an entirely new game label, new game publisher.
Oh.
Enjoy this first look at more than 12 games
Sizzle.
To make up its initial slate.
That's actually impressive. That
sometimes
that,
I ask myself what.
This publisher's got to have a lot of investment capital there. They can publish 6 games at once. Even if they're indie. That looked straight up like Returnal. How did that happen so fast? Wait, Payday? She was shooting a goddamn Hydralisk. Oh, that was Kingdom Come Deliverance 2. Probably. There were rumors that was going to get announced soon. Is this THQ Nordic? No. Wait, THQ Nordic rebranded as something else recently. Maybe it is THQ Nordic rebranding as something.
Is that who you are?
My purpose makes me who I am.
Little pizzicato bridge.
I finally have the feeling we're doing something worthwhile.
Being relied on to succeed where others would fail.
Wait, is that a Gungrave game? Are you? Oh, it's not a 2. Some of these games are already out. Right?
Prime Matter.
Okay. Gungrave got announced a while ago? Really? And I missed that.
There you have it. Prime Matter, Payday 3, 2. And there is actually one more game added to the mix. And for that, we go to Todd Hollinshead from Saber. Todd, how you doing?
Oh, great, Todd.
Jeff. Thank you for the intro.
Show
there.
Me
I'm
that
excited to
sweet,
have this little
sweet
last
ponytail.
Edition, which is that Saber and Prime Matter are working together on a new game in the Painkiller franchise.
Yay! Yay!
All right, very cool. On
Yay!
That, there are more details on Prime Matter.
Painkiller!
Stream at noon Pacific, 3 p.m.
Wait, that was it? That's all we get from Todd?
By. Next up is a
That's
brand
it.
New IP from a brand
right.
new studio, Stray Bombay. It's
right.
coming this fall.
Why did they have Todd on just to
PC
say that and show
game
a logo?
Pass on
it wasn't
day
even
one.
A logo of a new
it's
game.
The Anacrusis, a four-player cooperative first-person shooter set aboard a massive starship stranded at the edge of explored space.
I'm curious
you
here.
Team up with your friends in an infinitely replayable fight against alien hordes to unlock perks, weapons,
yeah, there it is.
And new ways
Bang.
To play that you can share with your team. Here
I did it.
Is the world premiere
Oop,
trailer.
No! World premiere. He said world premiere. That's a full shot. World premiere. Poor Todd.
Hello.
Yeah. I mean, everyone. All the most of that. Well, I guess Marty Stratton is still at id. But yeah. Todd Hollinshead was one of the last guys. Tim Willits was one of the last holdouts.
problem. Stick together and let's do this.
All right, so it's like a Left 4 Dead with aliens.
Is this a disco?
A jazzy Left 4 Dead?
This I do not like.
Huh.
Need some help. Pick your pose.
This is not good. Not good.
What if...
Left 4 Tarkov.
Doors and run. Just run. No stopping, no shooting, just straight to the bridge.
To the bridge!
Get that bridge here!
Heavy.
Really?
That's a very 70s logo. That fits.
I call them
all
brutes.
All that fits.
From Latin, brutus.
Yeah, it's a very 70s sci-fi.
Smart, calling them brutes.
Eon, you don't want to get in here and help name these?
Nah, I'm good.
Yeah, they have like the... Yeah, it's Left 4 Dead. I'm okay with that. I like Left 4 Dead. They even have like character chatter and stuff.
Awesome look. Thanks for that, Chet, and the team.
All right.
Ray Bombay.
Cheers.
Tomorrow, tune to the Summer Game Fest for a special deep dive presentation on New World, a new open world MMO.
Oh, that one fought back a little bit.
Set on the supernatural island of Aeternum.
Yeah, no thanks.
Finally coming out later this summer, and in the deep dive video,
it came out a few times already.
Scott Lane will take players into the mysterious supernatural island.
So THQ Nordic. Yeah, I think it's THQ Nordic rebranding.
Once you arrive, it's up to you to unite warring human factions.
I'm not quite sure if all those titles were THQ Nordic titles, but I'm pretty sure they were.
Unmake life. Scott and the team.
THQ Nordic has been a really interesting developer. They've made some really interesting bets on the games they publish, and they seem to have done it very cleanly.
Unique mechanics, bosses, loot, and
they've cleared a lot of money. They've grown. It's been really interesting to see THQ Nordic sort of acquire and blossom.
August 31st.
That makes any sense.
I will also be down at the studio to chat with Scott about the game and the team's efforts.
What was that Amazon game that you and Bruce hated? Well, I hated it. New World was that game. It was a fun game for the first, you know, 5 hours or so. But once I started to try to actually use the modes that were supposed to make it special,
at SummerGameFest.com.
I played MMOs that tried to do that before, and they all failed for similar reasons.
Teamed up with Fast and Furious, bringing some of the saga's most iconic cars.
Thought that was Crucible.
Game. And now
I didn't mind Crucible.
Back.
Crucible was the hero shooter that they mercy killed real early. I thought Crucible actually had quite a bit going for it. It was pretty well made. I went into it very cynically, but Crucible was all right. It actually won me over.
Well, maybe the most
New World did not.
Supersonic, acrobatic. Rocket-powered heist car ever conceived, the F9 Pontiac Fiero.
What? World premiere. That's a 0.5 then. There's a Fast 9 car coming to Rocket League again. World premiere. I love how this is the sound of Fast and Furious. Vaguely Central American pop music. New car just dropped.
Strap a rocket Celeste. Into a car
Very
and
nice.
Play soccer seems like the right idea to me. The Fast and Furious 3-car bundle arrives June 17th in Rocket League. Okay, next up, last year, a new Swedish company named Shark Mob released a teaser for their first unnamed multiplayer project in the Vampire the Masquerade universe.
Neat.
Tonight, we're putting a name on their first game with a brand new world premiere trailer.
World premiere, he said it. Oh, shit, man. This world premiere shit's gonna kill me. World premiere.
Centuries.
Oh, I got a box. Oh, okay, it's my new heatsink. I'm upgrading to AMD, y'all. I got tired of not having 25 cores in my CPU.
Influenced your society.
All right.
Fed on your blood.
Pickle Online 2 get canceled? No, just indefinitely delayed.
Thrive.
What CPU do you go with? The 5950X. I actually bought one of the new Intel ones. But then I read more reviews and benchmarks, and I was like, it was mostly the power consumption. The new Intel chips are hot and power hungry like crazy. And I don't know. I like rewarding clean engineering. I like rewarding efficient engineering. And I always liked AMD. I was a Radeon guy way back in the day. But NVIDIA, like, I like NVIDIA's tech. DLSS and RTX are very cool tech. But AMD is very much more the Linux kind of mentality of like open source everything, make it so it runs on every platform. NVIDIA is much more lock it down to our stuff. It's good business, but there's more hippie techno spirit in AMD, I think. Anyway, cheers, world premiere. Grr. Vampire Blood Hunt. This doesn't feel like World of Darkness at all. It kind of doesn't.
I can't wait to play this game.
It reminded me of, what is it, Morgoth?
Have to wait long. You
the
can
like,
sign up now.
The Legacy of Kain multiplayer shooter?
The closed alpha PC test available on July 2nd.
Blood DLSS Hunt is too good for me to go AMD. Well, I'm still going to have an NVIDIA
next,
video card.
Game series from the creators of Until Dawn.
But AMD
the House of Ashes,
is rolling out their version of DLSS this pretty soon. Nazgoth, that was the one. Thank you.
Iraqi soldiers stranded in a cursed temple. Here's the story trailer with the exclusive reveal of the monsters lurking in the depths.
I mean, that sounds like a cool setup. World premiere. World premiere. All right, I might have to back off on this world premiere stuff in a minute. Yeah, no politics. Oh, it's a Dark Pictures. Hell yeah. Fuck yes. I was gonna say this setup sounds awfully lot like a pulp comic setup.
From its slumber and is hungry.
Why isn't that? Shit. What's his name? Peter Stormare. We want Peter Stormare.
Sweeps of the war zone have uncovered what appears to.
Dude, this fucking rules. I am so into this. Like a Desert Storm style. Well, no wait. 03 was Desert Shield. No, that was still after. I don't know if that one had a name. But yeah.
To descend into the unknown alone is extreme.
Oh, this fucking rules! Like combatants stranded and then dealing with a supernatural element? That is so, like, that is so in the lane.
Would it be a case of...
Oh, is it Operation Iraqi Freedom? Alright, thank you. Yeah, how'd that go? How free is Iraq right now? How many McDonald's are there? What's the per capita McDonald's rating of Iraq? That's how we know that our military operations were a success.
Depends on the choices.
Desert Tarkov, now we're doing it.
They will be as a company.
All right, cheers.
Guiding you through the unknown.
So many horrible B-movies using this premise. Yeah, that I mean, that's... It's called the Dark Pictures Anthology for a reason. It's a horror anthology. It's camp. I mean, the first one had, like, some World War II vets finding an ancient relic on a ship.
One by one.
It was like, these guys understand what they're doing, and I love it. I love it! I've been waiting for this kind of thing in gaming for a long time. Anthology works that are interactive, and they actually seem to be making a go of it. I was worried the first Dark Pictures anthology would be the last.
Will you find the path to salvation?
Because a lot of that stuff,
or be lost in the.
Whenever somebody tries to do an anthology series, it tends to fizzle out pretty fast. But
forever.
House of Ashes. There was one before this. There was Man of Medan, and there was. Shoot, did that one ever come out? The second Dark Pictures anthology. Or is that the second one? Oh, Little Hope. That's right. I never played Little Hope. That's out? Did that come out? What came out?
One
okay.
One of the longest, most beloved JRPG franchises in the industry.
Dragon Quest?
Tales of series. Oh. Well, the latest game, Arise, was announced 2 years ago, and it brings.
Was Until Dawn part of it? Not really. Same devs, but Until Dawn was a PlayStation
exclusive.
Here's
a world premiere look at
world
the
premiere.
Latest trailer with Fuck. More information following in the coming weeks.
He said world premiere. He said world premiere. Wait, world premiere? What? Trailer is coming in the coming weeks, so this is just a sample of a trailer. Until Dawn got all David Caged.
Fancy place they got here.
It sort of did, but
in coexistence between the Renans and the Danans.
Oh boy, and we got some Ruby shit.
Dohilim Ilkaris.
The Renans and the Danans. I am Abatu Al It Abdi Tabla Dabladab.
I'm Captain Kisara of the Elder Menin.
Have fun writing that out on the front of a Funko box.
From now on, when I fight to protect my dream.
Well, this crew just gets bigger and bigger.
I'm an anime guy.
Textbook villain, thank you for the prime.
Seems the rumors you were running with them were...
Oh, I fucking love this shit. It's so stupid. I am the taciturn female lead. Maybe given enough time, I'll fall in love with the protagonist. Provided we're half submerged in water at some point.
Olaf, get the hell out of my realm.
World premiere.
And it's ours, understand?
The Tales of series fucking rules. It is anime the game. Every Tales of game is anime the game. They're all 90 hours long.
Is it over?
Look at that posture.
Just begun.
That man had a concave ab. You know you're an anime boy when you stand like this. You gotta like really curve it out. Look at all those logos. Le Petit Prince. We got some anime to chase it. Oh, that game company. Oh, is this their new thing? I've been waiting for so long to see what they're working on. They didn't even get a world premiere.
For Summer Game Fest, we have a special announcement for you. That the console version of Sky Children of the Light would arrive to Nintendo Switch on June 29th.
Cool.
And the Little Prince season would start soon after on July 6th.
Cool.
Enjoy the game.
I will. Wait, am I supposed to know this? Sky? Is this a thing? Wait.
One of the things I take great pleasure in is using a platform like this show to introduce you to new developers and studios with games that deserve the spotlight. That's definitely the case with this next title from a small Swedish studio named Wishfully. Planet of Lana tells the story of a young
girl
and her loyal friend who embark on a mission through a colorful world that's designed to feel
thanks
like
for the Prime.
A gouache.
Oh, it's a mobile game. Okay. Oh, it's on phones.
Here's your first look at the Planet of Lana coming to Xbox and PC in 2022.
First look? Are you telling me it's a... Oh! You know what? I'm gonna call a bye on that one. I'm just going to drink water this time. Drink water, everybody. Nope. I lied. I'm actually going to do it. Hold on. It's a halves. He didn't say it. That's true. He didn't say it. He didn't say it, that's true. The cup is full of White Claw. Alright, there's a cat. There's a cat ball. This man with beady. It Tark's Twav. We really do need an It Takes Two spinoff for Tarkov. Thunder and Wishfully present. Thunderful. Is there any more? Oh my gosh! Can you think of cards to introduce an indie game more powerful than Thunderful and Wishfully present a hand-painted adventure? Where are the orbs? Show me the orbs, damn it! Let's not be coy. We both know there are gonna be orbs. Got that mid-90s world music. All it needs is a pan flute. I'm in, though. This seems rad. I'll play it. I don't remember the name, though. What was the name? Space Planet. A Space Odyssey. It was like an off-world adventure. Planet of Flana. Planet of Lana. There we go. Planetoflana. Got it.
What a beautiful artistic game on our show. Well, joining me now is Aaron Keller, who's the game director of Overwatch 2. Aaron, great to have you here.
Whoa.
Live. Thanks for joining
That's
us.
A bit of a...
Thank you so much for having us here.
I thought he was going
to
talk about Planetoflana.
What's planned for Overwatch 2? You guys recently, you had a PvP live stream.
Is this new Jeff?
And you revealed some changes coming to Overwatch 2. What can you tell us? What's the latest?
Yeah, so we recently announced that Overwatch 2's format is changing to a 5v5 team format. This requires
this swoop.
A fresh look at all of our heroes.
My man's got an anime spike.
It should feel new yet familiar to fans of our strategic team-based combat.
Yeah, it was great to see you guys playing, and long awaited for people to get a chance to go hands-on with it. And today, I know you brought us a look at some skins for some of the characters, right?
Oh, I thought we were going to see the game.
The team is so passionate updating the look and the feel of the world of Overwatch. And one aspect of that is creating entirely new models for Overwatch 2
for
all of our heroes.
They're really going to hit us with skins today.
Baptiste and Sombra.
Let's
take a look here, and I know you're going to tell us a little bit about what
premiere?
We're seeing, but it's so cool to see these.
So Blizzard is in full Valve mode now, huh?
Yeah,
actually, that looks pretty good.
Yeah, so
that looks pretty cool.
And there's
that a looks lot cool.
of new technology that go into
They've
our...
They've shown a fair amount of gameplay so far. I know they have. I just wanted to see more.
shader tech, excuse me, in order to get the look that we're going for with his haircut. He also has a glowing cape and gloves that kind of give that...
Oh, look at him go.
...surgeon vibe to him.
Wow. Look at him go. He's rolling and throwing... I haven't played as Baptiste once. I don't know that I have had Overwatch installed since Baptiste.
This was a very challenging look for us to update. It's an asymmetrical design. There's so many layers of hair and clothing and technology in this. If you look closely, you can actually see
her toes
and nodes embedded in her clothing.
You really don't have to look that closely. I like the ribbon cables across the hair. That's pretty neat.
For fans to see these characters, you know.
Ribbon cable is like it's something that doesn't exist anymore. Everything's serial now, but it's such a cool look.
More on the game. We appreciate you giving us a little sneak preview here, and I'm sure there'll be more later this year on Overwatch.
You bet. Thank you.
Awesome. All right. Thanks very much.
I loved her character setup, that she was always interested in the Chisme.
Dark Alliance with the game developer Jeff Haddam.
She was always getting people's dirty laundry.
Moon from the WWE. That's right. You didn't expect me to say that. But this game is a ton of fun, and it's coming.
Hannibal Buress from the WWE.
22nd.
Did I just hear that? Is Hannibal Buress a wrestler now?
Hey guys, it's Jeff Keighley, and today as part of Summer Game Fest, we're going hands-on with a game that is coming out in just a couple of weeks. It is Dark Alliance.
Production team fucking on it, man.
Jeff, one of the game developers from 2K,
they're
Jeff,
scaling it up.
Special guests, Hannibal Buress and Ember Moon.
Oh, okay, that WWE. Okay. All right.
That looks like a trap.
Oh,
that
spice.
Looks like a trap.
Oh my god.
Traps.
Look at that jacket.
Oh shit.
Hannibal came to play.
A warrior's death, I died again.
I'm coming to get you.
Hey.
Watch it.
Oh. Man, they all wore their battle gear. Hell yeah.
Oh no. Oh no, I can't believe I'm down. I'm down, people.
The developer's down?
The dev is down.
So, Ember, I know you really wanted to be Drizzt.
Absolutely.
Right?
Everybody wants to be Drizzt.
Books, especially the Drizzt backstory.
Fuck yeah.
I connected with it on such an intimate level to the point where my wrestling character that everyone sees on TV is actually based on this.
No shit! I had no idea.
Even though Drizzt has purple, I just love everything about him, that he's just constantly the good guy the entire time.
Oh, what the?
Drizzt rules.
The Verbeek Chef.
He is magical and has daggers and casts spells and.
Let me see what you got. You ain't got nothing on us, baby.
I'm here now.
Whoa!
I remember reading King Killer Chronicles.
Come on.
And one of the things that turned me off was that it really felt like Voth was just a Drizzt knockoff.
Damn.
He's not. Eventually, but yeah, it did seem like just the coolest dude. That was pretty good.
Act complete.
That was great.
Yeah.
He has scimitars. What the fuck? Oh, okay. I always see imagery of Drizzt with like little elven daggers. Hey, what? That's me. I was in that. Is fan favorite character Abel going to be playable? I'm sure. Well, okay. Well, not yet, but all right. Well, hold on. Now the next character I'm sure will be. Not quite yet, but wait a minute and hear it. No. Well, maybe it's DLC. Maybe they want to tease out the most popular character in the show for some other kind of monetization, you know? Maybe. I'm sure that's what it is.
All right, Summer Game Fest kickoff live presented by Prime Gaming continues.
He'll be a mount.
Yesterday
works
was
for
an
me.
Amazing tease of the
I'll
next
be a mount.
Battle
I got a strong back.
From EA. And if you want to dust up on the history of the franchise, its last big modern-day game, that was Battlefield 4. It's this month. Prime Gaming members get to download it and play it for free through June 20th. Now, there's no catch. This is the full-blown PC version of the 2013 game, and those only in Battlefield moments
still
hold up.
Holy fuck, 2013?
Gaming.amazon.com to your free copy right now if you're an
we're
Amazon
all gonna die.
Prime member.
Ugh.
This Sunday, watch the Xbox and Bethesda Game Showcase for the first gameplay footage of Battlefield 2042.
Okay, I will.
It'll be really cool. All right,
Steel
right
Dingo.
Now,
Thank
let's
you
take
for the
a
prime.
Look at another world
Hashtag
premiere.
Prime. Hashtag
Monster Hunter Stories is coming to the Switch.
He
in
said
July.
World premiere. Fuck.
We've got your first look at the story trailer.
World premiere. You sure did. All right. Yep. Okay, so I'm changing the rule now. Only verbal world premieres count, and they are still a full shot.
Wings of ruin.
But it's hitting me. I'm getting hit right now. I'm getting into E3 mode. Yeah. 11 out of 10 of these shots have been world premiere. Yeah, that's why I had it as a rule. Again, I was saying this when we started. Jeff Keighley, and only Jeff Keighley, loves world premieres. Loves them. So these rules are not going to be as killer in other conferences, but Jeff Keighley specifically,
we can't let
he loves
you interfere
it.
With our plans.
Loves it. Real villain, thank you for the prime.
That's the monster.
Is there an exclamation point command for the rules? No, because they're right there all the time. Maybe that's a bit of an eyesore, and maybe I can just, like, take that away. Whatever. Madman Madsen, thank you for the prime.
You
anyway.
Suppose he saw this
world
coming?
Premiere. Bill's a fan, too?
We
yeah.
Will let you awaken it.
Maybe the Bethesda Xbox conference will have a lot of world premieres, but... Story's two. I don't know. There was one. 10 shots before noon. Yeah.
You're going to be bored.
Crested noon in the last 15 minutes, but... Neat. Those stickers are cute. Don't overdo it. This isn't a Doom Eternal drunk stream. It's just world premieres. I love world premieres! I'm not doing this for you. I'm doing this for me.
Next, this legendary rock band hits the road this summer on the Hella Mega Tour with Green Day and Fall Out Boy. But first, they came together with an indie developer
the Hella
to
Mega
create
Tour?
Stream-safe music for the community. Yes, you can co-stream this performance. So turn it up.
I was going to do it anyway.
Their brand new, never-before-released
You get three strikes.
Song,
who cares?
Tell me what you want from Wavebreak. This is Weezer.
Gotta give credits to Weezer, though. They've been going for, what, 25, 30 years now? Oh my gosh. Rivers has gone from ironic dad to literal dad.
This is a message that my manager wouldn't approve.
Look at all these dads. He's still got his little lightning bolt strap.
Influenced by an office full of dorks. I won't mention any names. Pitchfork.
Oh!
Tell me what you want.
Get him, Rivers.
I'm gonna get right on it. Tell me what you want. I'll write it down in my notebook. Duly noted.
You guys look bored as fuck. That's been their steez for years, man. You don't have to mute for copyright or I don't give a shit. Also, they just said it's not a problem. Let me throw this out there, alright? Streamers are some dramatic ass bitches. DMCA is not that big of a deal. All you have to do is not play Kendrick Lamar albums front to back on your goddamn stream. Or stream a modern TV show while you're grinding World of Warcraft.
Everyone's entitled to their own opinions.
What do you mean? Steph asked if rock and roll is dead. How is this anything different than anything they played on the Blue Album? The difference is you're not young anymore.
Tell me what you want.
You're not old, though. We're just grown adults now.
Yeah.
Weezer never lost it. Yeah, same with Green Day, actually. I mean, Green Day has actually kind of followed musical trends to their credit, I think. It kind of speaks to their ability to make marketable music. But when they choose to, they can still put out some really great punk. It's just nobody, like, that scene's not there anymore. Green Day fell the fuck off. I disagree. Listen to Uno, Dos, and Trey. They put out a 3-pack of albums in, like, I think 2014? 2013? Something like that? They are so bad. What, you don't like Uno, Dos, and Trey? I don't know. I thought Uno, Dos, and Trey were a 3-pack of ass. Really? To me, those albums were like, this is Dookie again. They know how to do it. They just choose not to because nobody's buying it. That's what happens when you fill arenas. You gotta walk that line. That was a solid track. It's interesting that Weezer is wrapped around into doing tracks about having shitty critics.
The game released tomorrow. Nintendo Switch.
Talk shit.
Streaming platforms, Twitch soundtrack.
That's always when a band matures, is when they write a clapback track to music critics.
Right now, let's turn to a game that we announced.
Disagree, used to be a massive Green Day fan too, and they've gotten worse and worse.
Dungeon from Amplitude. We showed a brief.
I would venture.
In December, and fans wanted more. Well, here's an extended.
Consider that, like, so Boulevard of Broken Dreams to me was like that was the anti Green Day. But there was a whole new generation, and that track blew their minds. So I do think there's a certain magic to being 14 and listening to Green Day. And I don't think it's the band's fault that you can't be 14 again. That said, I'm not a music critic.
Learn it,
nor am I like, I don't consider myself to be like
option B, then.
Educated enough on music theory to be able to make that statement without just shooting from the hip. So I'm not sticking to my guns on that statement. That's just kind of like, this reminds me of, what is it, Alien Swarm?
And if it goes, you go.
This looks rad.
Yep. Just like that. Rule number three. Watch your squat.
Fans usually change as they get older, but they stayed the same.
The turf.
Green Day changed.
You can't do everything by yourself.
Green Day on the aughts was different than Green Day in the 90s. Green Day in the 10s was different than Green Day in the aughts. Music critics are among the most useless critics. I'm going to venture that every critic is among the most useless critic.
Well, if you've got all that going, but you still can't.
The internet has made critics pointless.
You
gotta
choose the squad.
Critics are only there for other critics?
I'm in.
Those look like Samus shoulder pads. Critics are there for other critics and for the enthusiast market. But they're no longer the like disseminating tastemaker.
What are you guys doing tonight?
For mass market.
If you're lucky enough to have a PS5, you're probably getting ready to play Ratchet and Clank.
Final Fantasy Integrate, baby!
A ton of fun. Well, later today, the team at Insomniac is going to be doing a special launch stream on Twitch. And to tell us more, take it away, Marcus.
If you can
Mike.
Find a critic that lines up with some of your tastes, they're great for curation.
Hey, Jeff,
that's
and
true.
Everybody watching Summer Games Fest kickoff live. Marcus Smith here, creative director at Insomniac Games for Ratchet and Clank Rift Apart. We're excited that players finally get a chance to play the game tomorrow, and to celebrate, we want to spend some more time with you today. At 2 p.m. Pacific, 5 p.m. Eastern, to live stream the first hour of Rift Apart. Isn't that right, Mike?
That's right. I'm Mike Daly, the game director of Rift Apart. In addition to playing through the opening of the game, we'll also be taking your questions live and talking about what it was like to develop the game behind the scenes. So please join us at twitch.tv/insomniacgames at 2 p.m. Pacific, 5 p.m. Eastern.
I feel like technical critics, cars, tech, etc. still have a utility. Yeah, because that's more of a buying guide. It's a consumer tool.
We'll see you there.
Is this product worth the money? That does have value. The breaking
right,
down a creative work.
One and only Giancarlo Esposito.
And providing commentary on it.
Cry six.
I don't know.
Giancarlo, thank you for
that practice
us.
Has been democratized very fully.
This role.
They came to me with this phenomenal idea and had proposed that I play Anton Castillo, the leader of Yara, with this big vision and dream for his country. And it really appealed to me because he was a guy who first came from a love of his family and a love of his community and country. And it was so in line with what's going on in the world politically today. And what
don't say that, Giancarlo. It's a Ubisoft game.
Opportunity.
Nope.
The other part of it is
has nothing to do with what's going on.
It's so brand new. It excites me as a filmmaker that I wanted to be a part of it.
All right, well, you've played some absolutely amazing villains in your career. What was it like being a video game
social
villain?
Issue? It's not a segment.
No, I'm
wait,
not a
is it a segment?
I got to push back on you. I'll let you finish. But this guy loves his country. He wants to empower you, Keely. He wants to empower
it is kind of a segment, but it is about a game.
Stand up and speak your truth. Now, you can go back to calling me a villain if you like.
Well, you are smiling on the box. You're a good guy, right?
No good villains think no, they're the villain.
Feel
come on.
Like we as human beings fall in line. And I want to
Far Cry 4 was the last good Far Cry.
Within reason.
Far Cry 2 was the last good Far Cry.
Part and parcel of us falling in line.
I wish I had glasses I could pull down.
And thinking about the
Far Cry 1 was rad. Far Cry 2 tried something. Far Cry 3 was just populist trash. And then we've been off to the races ever since then.
And say
there, I said it.
I do agree that there are good and bad about all.
There, I said it.
This guy, out of his love and passion for his people, even if they're faceless to him at certain points in time, allow him to be an absolute hero.
Speaking of your character,
we're in hot take territory. I'm 11 shots in, so.
It's so interesting.
Far Cry Predator actually fucking rules. Far Cry Predator actually did some cool shit.
And it is Cuba, an island that had so many resources, but really the dream of the ability of the dictator to cultivate those resources. Something got in the way.
Far Cry 2 was like the last daring Ubisoft game, which sucks because they were so artistically avant-garde at like the turn of Gen 7. And then I guess they got burned because they were too artistic, and then they just retreated fully.
Zodiac signs.
I think it was like after Assassin's Creed 1, when everyone was like, it's too repetitive. And then they made Assassin's Creed 2 like a mini-map explosion. Ever since then, it's just been...
And studied political science and all this in college. So anyways.
Actually, Unity had some shit going for it.
All right,
but.
Well, one last question for you. Who would
Lovable
win in a
Sith Lord. Thank you for the prize.
Gus Fring, Moff Gideon,
and Thunderball
and
Katarina, thank you guys.
You know, and I have my favorites in those two.
But did they get burned on? Not selling enough. Question. That was the burn. AC-1 was garbage. You know, I disagree.
Immediately.
AC-1 was daring.
I say Moff Gideon.
Yeah.
Immediately. You know, somehow, I think Gus is colder. And displays that coldness in a very particular way.
His Moff Gideon was
awesome. I think
Anton
could be the most violent man on Earth.
Rogue One had so many good performances that were packed into like one scene.
May not have the time. Moff Gideon is otherworldly. This guy thinks in a different way, and he knows what you're thinking before you say it. Mm. And he does all his own dirty work. And he has an incredible tool to help him out. So I'm going to say Moff Gideon.
Fair enough.
Right. Wait, he was Mandalorian. Sorry.
Thank you so much.
Not Rogue. Rogue was Ben Mendelsohn.
In Far Cry 6.
And I can't wait for it to begin. Let the games begin!
If you haven't picked up on it yet, Prime Gaming unlocks a ton of...
It's only a joke in my head
on Prime
that
members. Like an exclusive
Dracula Untold or whatever
Legends,
ends with the track from the
GTA cash every week to play GTA
with Dracula Prime, flying into the sky.
Guys,
anyway.
You get a special Burning Circuits costume for your bean through June 21st. Now, speaking of Fall Guys, the time has come to reveal a brand new costume coming to the game based on legendary
the Dracula Matrix. That's the coolest movie ever. World premiere. What? Yo, why doesn't that bean have tits and butt? I guess it, 2B is more of an ass girl, but damn. Oh my gosh. Oh my gosh. Beautiful. I would be mad, but there's already a 2B outfit in Final Fantasy 14, so it works out. 2Bean? Exactly. 2B is all ass, all sass. Eh. Didn't this game fall in popularity? I mean, probably. Just because something gets accidentally popular and then kind of falls off that podium doesn't mean that it's a bad game. Most games do. Thank you, Kaw. Yeah, I gotta admit, I'm getting a little frustrated at people judging a game's value by how long it can be a sustainable mass market game. Not everything is gonna be number one forever. Nor should it. Life is too chaotic, and what people want is so fleeting and ephemeral. What am I looking at right now?
The birds come!
Oh, this is Genshin Impact. Never mind. Right. Hashtag ad.
So today we've announced games, a publisher, Prime Matter, so why not announce a developer too? And joining me now are Dave Anthony and Jason Blundell from the newly formed...
Are you saying it's a world premiere
games.
Developer?
We know you guys well from all your amazing work over the years at Treyarch and Call of Duty Black Ops, but What can we expect from your
that
new
logo? Is well, like hyper 2020
and,
logo.
Look, Jason and I, we've been mates for donkeys.
Anything that's styled after the Fortnite logo is going to be very dated in like 3 years.
And we've been working together for decades. And we've
anyway, sorry. I hate for that to be the first thing I say after a new developer's
and,
telling us about all their hard work.
When you're working on those franchises, the long-established IPs, you're working within very, very tight constraints creatively about what you can do.
So it's like an eye should be tipped the other way. You know, I disagree.
What if we deviate?
I think the shape of the logo is actually really solid. So you have the like box that's italicized, and then the eyes kind of flying back the other way. I think it does make a good combination of shapes, especially with the.
Not just to make a brand new IP, which is what
it starts with, like, and like dev is like the first breakout like syllable that you see.
It's very core.
Dev at on.
Deviation Games.
I mean, it kind of makes sense.
Really, really simple. It's there's no place for
I think
ego.
It's actually a pretty clean logo design. I'm more about the font. The font and the like the fat letters that are themselves italicized.
Big ideas from you guys as we would expect. Now, I know it's
and if I were to analyze it further, it's a developer that's always shooting to the future but with a mind of the past. Right?
Yeah, I mean you're very right there, Jeff. Very early, but
the eyes deviate. There it is. Yep. We're a developer that celebrates individuality, and we understand our culture. I'm talking over everything they're saying.
Creative, collaborative people, and bring them together kind of under one roof, and that's what Deviation Games is. So, we don't have anything to show right now, but that collaboration, that imagination is going on.
I know for a fact that people hate to hear negative feedback on their logos. I mentioned it once in a tongue-in-cheek manner, and the guy that let it fester got back to me a few weeks later. He really didn't like it.
Excited about it.
Yeah, because there's tons of effort and time and thought that go into that work.
Let's take a look at
that. I think it's a solid logo. I'm just more like the font. Thanks to me, Fortnite. In 10 years, I'm going to see this logo and realize that it came from the 2020s. That's it. That's all. It's a solid logo. I love it. Welcome to the world of video games, Deviation.
Okay, big news. The stage.
I hope for nothing better than nothing but success.
PlayStation.
I guess you've already been signed to PlayStation Studios.
PlayStation.
So.
Can you tell us about that partnership?
That's right, Jeff. And the partnership with PlayStation, it's all about quality. From soup to nuts, this project.
It looks Y2K.
Is all about quality.
Y2K was different. Although I think I know what you mean. Y2K did have a lot of bounding boxes around logos, but they were all gradients and like shiny shits.
And the partnership with Sony, it's very, very simple. I mean, God, just look at the track.
Y2K aesthetic has yet to really break, but I've seen some attempts for it.
Hit after hit.
Award
after award.
Y2K aesthetic is really, really interesting, and I feel like it's about time for it to blow up again.
It's really clear how the money.
I mean, this is like.
So we couldn't be more proud to expand.
There's like this
portfolio,
what I associate with
in a very, very significant way.
Wipeout.
Face it, right? Sony rocks. Mecha, and they get our kind of brand of crazy, so we're that's very right, happy with this partnership.
All right.
It's all like very like neo 70s.
Brand new IP, a mega IP. It sounds like coming in the future, and hopefully we'll see you guys.
A lot of drop shadows. A lot of thick bold lettering.
Awesome. All right, Dave, Jason, thank you very much, guys. All right. Well, this year is the 30th anniversary.
It's weird to look at like logo design and realize that a lot of it is based around what graphics like.
Sonic Symphony performance.
What goodies graphic software could offer. You can basically track the trajectory of Photoshop logos. Like, oh, we could do. Oh, here we go. We gotta pray up for Sonic. Sonic Unleashed. We're playing Sonic Unleashed, the Werehog game. We're not doing Green Hill Zone, no. Sonic Unleashed. Are we doing Flying Battery Zone? No. Sonic Unleashed. Oh yeah, I guess Fortnite Fun is the Helvetica of gaming right now. I mean, it was Impact for the longest. Well, no, what? No, no. I guess I'm thinking of Inside Gaming. We always used it. What was it? Agency FB. Yeah. How was one supposed to talk in chat? Milo, I think you figured it out. Congratulations. You've acquired a new skill today. Love you, Sonic. Oh my gosh. In wrestling class the other day, like last night, people started talking about Sonic characters, and I was like, Jesus Christ, do I out myself right now? And they were like, when does Sonic go silver? And I had to be like, silver's another character. He's from the future. He has psychic powers. And they're like, what is the pink hedgehog? And I was like, I can't say it. Ha ha ha. Yeah, Tom, dude, I lawn darted myself directly into the mat. My back is actually kind of fucked up today. I definitely fucked something up. But I'm good. I slept okay. It's like when I move my head in particular ways. No, actually. I took a real bad bump, like it knocked the wind out of me. But I'm way more ambulatory today than I thought I'd be. YouTube.com/Sonic. June 23rd. Alright, let me love put that in my calendar
music.
Here.
All right, Sunday. Warner Brothers Games and Turtle Rock.
Did he just say Love Orchestra Music?
At the zombie multiplayer fun of Back for Blood. And right now we've got
love that music
of a new boss and news on the beta.
When they sequence those notes in 4x4, can't get enough of it. When world-class musicians start making those audio waves, comes into my ear and I feel good about it. Let's see, your June 20th. It's a Wednesday? I'm excited for this game. Very much. Any Left 4 Dead-like, I'm all about. And this is from the OGs. Evolve didn't work out, so gotta go back to the well. God, it's so good. What a good logo work, too. With them standing in a four.
One of the things I'm most passionate about is getting you guys access to play more games.
It reminds me of like the Left 4 Dead 2 with like the like fingers chewed off. I was like, that's so fucking brilliant.
Next Fest starts next Wednesday, and Xbox is back again to do an ID at Xbox demo event, which I'm announcing right now.
I'll take Darktide over this.
It starts
but what if you
Tuesday
get both?
It's completely free, no badges required. One of the games I'm most excited about in the lineup is Tunic from my fellow Canadian Andrew Scholdice.
Here I'm excited for Tunic.
A little sneak preview.
Wait, that game's already out.
Demo, which you can
oh, no, wait, it's
Xbox
not. I played the demo
on Tuesday.
Like 2 years ago. Never mind. This is like Wolf Zelda. Lord Dubs, thank you for the Prime.
My name's Andrew Scholdice, and I'm working on Tunic, which is an isometric action-adventure about
when did he last take a shot? It's been a while, which is to say like 15 minutes maybe.
And find secrets.
The problem is I have to use the restroom.
I started working on it about 6 years ago.
So I'm going to do that. I'm going to use the restroom. I'll be right back.
It's
Tunic.
Changing
this game looks really cute.
Over the years, but I'm really excited about where we've gotten to today. So in Tunic, you start the game, and you are a little fox that's washed up on a beach, and you don't have a whole lot of context except for, you know, lust for adventure, and you are going to wander off, and maybe you're going to find a stick, and maybe if you venture a little bit further, maybe you're going to find a sword. And it's really about that sense of discovery, about wondering what's around the next corner. People have played the game at shows before, but we wanted to put together a brand new demo that was, you know, for the home audience. And so it's full of never before seen stuff, a brand new dungeon, a bunch of areas people haven't seen before.
So excited about Tunic, and Sable also is going to be one of the games in that, along with a lot of other awesome titles, so check that out next week on Xbox. Next up, stave off Ragnarok in this ancient Norse-inspired co-op action survival RPG that you can also fully play solo. Classic hack-and-slash gameplay goes Viking in Norsefell's Tribes of Midgard, launching on PlayStation and PC July 27th. Here
muted
is
my
the
mic.
Brand new trailer.
The giants have come to Midgard.
Wait, Jeff tweeted something really ominous. I mean, he shouldn't be tweeting anything right now. He's in the middle of a live production. That means it's scheduled.
Drofti. Your tribe's journey starts in the wilderness. Hunt down pets, gather rare resources.
Oh, he tweeted it's almost time. That means it's Elden Ring.
Once you've flung it, all you can carry.
Here's the thing. I know that Jeff, like, if my read about him is right, and that he is a pretty cutthroat businessman, and I can guarantee you he is fiending for the Elden Ring premiere, which means he was probably throwing around money, he was, like, sending emails, he was pressuring people. I think if anybody could get it, he could. And if he was angling for it, He's probably got it. So the thing is, Namco's their like conference is on Monday, so it may be like a twofer. He might have a tease, and then Namco has the like full reveal. We'll see. Well, that's assuming that Namco Bandai is publishing Elden Ring. I don't think there's. I don't know. From has said who's publishing that game. Strength of your tribe, because those giants. Because From Software is still an independent developer. They're one of the last big indie devs.
And it's time for us to end their path of destruction.
Oh, Lord Devs, thank you for the prime.
Let's show them our might is greater than their height.
Did I say Namco Bando? Because it used to be Namco Bandai, and then they switched it to Bandai Namco. I don't know. There was some point where they swapped the names. Whatever. 11 shots. I'm allowed to mix some things
Who's
up.
Ready for some Evil Dead?
Oh.
We announced this game last December at TGA, and now it's time for an extended look at the gameplay.
Well, isn't this just like Dead by Daylight, but Evil Dead, Brandon?
Tim Willits from Saber.
Tim Willits!
Hi, Jeff.
Wow.
Great to see you.
We got all the id Software
Today, we have
luminaries here, huh?
Extended footage.
Again with the Quake 3.
Evil Dead, the game.
Fucking Todd Holland said that too.
We are excited to show you this. And to help me explain it,
Bandov Tarko.
Thank you.
Everyone liked Halo Combat Evolved, but Quake 3 was there first. These babies don't know about Quake 3 Arena. Quake 4 Remaster confirmed. I wouldn't mind that. And then we get our Peter Stormare. Cinematic attack?
Hola, cyber friends. I'm Bruce Campbell. You know me as Ash Williams, the dude who saved the world from evil.
He did call me a cyber friend.
I'm bringing you the lowdown on the upcoming Evil Dead the Game.
The Game?
You and your friends will team
I'm gonna say it.
Classic Evil Dead hero.
Bruce Campbell got shortchanged by this world.
You'll use savage finishing moves or tear evil a new one. Or if you're not into the whole save the
Watch that guy in Evil Dead 2 in his goddamn prime? Handsome as fuck. Like solid performer.
You can play as the vile Kandarian.
He should have been a world class lead.
But who would want to do that? He'd be a dick.
With instead, the possession in your arsenal, he got to be in a bunch of like B TV series from the Raimis. Which is not that bad, really.
You can do that if you're a dick. Whether you choose the path of evil or righteousness, you'll be throwing down in places you've seen before.
Bruce Campbell Mysterio? Oh. I mean, Gyllenhaal did a really good job. It's really hard to, like, have any issue with that performance, but Bruce Campbell would be an amazing lead. An amazing Mysterio. He's got that smarminess about him. Bruce Campbell was hot in Darkman? He was in Darkman? That was Liam Neeson. But for now, I mean, I'll leave you with this knowing line. The Raimis, he had a cameo somewhere. It's been no many years since I've seen Darkman.
Always wore brown pants.
Spider-Man, that's the best you got? He was in Burn Notice. That's true. No, he's worked. It would be more tragic if he just didn't have any work for his entire career. Bruce Campbell's himself in anything? Yeah, I feel like sometimes that's the problem. If you nail a role too hard, if you're too good at it, then that's all anyone thinks of you as. What a weird problem to have. Bubba Hotep was a fun and weird movie. Oh, he was at the very end. Dark man with a new face in the crowd for 5 seconds. Ah, I see. You never know. Maybe he chose not to be
guys,
in big movies. That's true.
Now it's time for the
world premiere
finale to the show.
World premiere. Say it, Jeff.
This is extremely special.
Say it.
Today, I am so deeply honored to be given the opportunity to share this next game. It comes from one of our industry's most acclaimed developers and a previous Game of the Year winner at the Game Awards. I want to personally thank this developer for believing in my vision of Summer Game Fest as a new way to bring all of us
all right.
together
a little masturbatory,
for a cross-industry showcase.
Do what you got to do.
Kick off the summer in the right way. So, without further ado, please sit back and enjoy this truly spectacular world premiere.
World premiere!
It is finally time.
Yeah, it's got to be. Elden Ring! It's got to be. There's no way he'd say that about anything but Elden Ring. It's armor! It's medieval armor! Yes! Oh, okay, it is Bandai Namco. Which means we might even get to see more gameplay during their conference. Really? We have a hooded lady whispering at me already? Boy, we're just...
Guided by grace. Once lost.
Yeah. I don't want this to just be Souls again. I mean, if it is another Souls game, fine.
To its core.
Okay, you get a horse. Don't... If it's Souls with a Hyrule Field? I don't know. I gotta have faith in From. Okay. Alright. Okay, alright, okay. I'm getting like Metal Gear Solid vibe, or 5 vibes from the open world.
In search of the Elden Ring. Emboldened by the flame of ambition. Someone must extinguish thy flame.
We got dodge rolls and blocks.
They will fight.
We got a charge move.
And they will die.
We got a level up lady in a hood.
In an unending curse.
We got horse jumps. Wolfmans. Okay, there's a lot getting implied here. Oh! Co-op spirits.
For how else is a champion or a lord to be born?
Well, a lowly tarnished.
So I'm gonna guess that the horse jump is like, you get abilities that help you traverse an open world. I'm gonna guess it's a Souls Metroidvania. Which is pretty rad. And a lot of this monster design is A+. But so far I don't see anything that would make this not Dark Souls 4. Not that it has to be, but whatever.
Brandish the Elden Ring. For all of us.
Rad. Absolutely rad. Ooh. It's even got the iconography. Like, Nightman dying with a sword. He's not slumped against a wall, but... Why is that not Dark Souls 4? Whatever, it doesn't matter.
Elden
they can do whatever they want.
Is coming, as you saw, January 21st, 2022, to next gen, current gen. It's so incredible, and I want to thank so much Miyazaki-san and the team at From for sharing that in-game.
What did you
look
expect?
I
mean, when it comes to From Software,
oh God, I'm free
in the past.
All right.
You could expect anything. From Software made a wide range of shit.
Developers who took part. And for you and watching around the world, it means so much
so
to me.
I think it's okay to throw the boundaries off when it comes to a FromSoft game.
Week,
at least it used to be. I think now that they've broken into like being a AAA world-class dev, they're couching their bets a little bit.
Well.
They're not quite as unrestrained as they used to be.
Schedule. And this is really just the kickoff to summer and a ton of other amazing events that I'm fully supportive of.
Yeah, Chrome Hounds, Enchanted Arms. FromSoft has made a variety of wacky-ass games, but I don't think they have that liberty anymore.
Opening Night Live. And this December, I am so happy to say that the Game Awards will return as an in-person ceremony.
Yeah, Polywag, thank you for the Prime.
In Los Angeles. More details are coming later this summer. Thanks again for being a part of Summer Game Fest. We will see you tomorrow for more, and stay tuned for the Day of the Dead.
Right on.
I am 8-Bit and Double Fine right now. Good night, everybody.
That was a solid showing for Elden Ring. I'm intrigued. For me, a big reason that I play through any Souls game is just to see the artistic design of new environments, new bosses, and boy, did it seem like that game's going to have it in spades. Not a huge fan of award shows, but it's watchable this way. Ah, I mean, this wasn't an award show, so it works out. I'm okay to keep, let's see here. I'm okay to keep going. I do have to, I got some other things going on today, but I think I can keep this going. Please don't be on this monitor. Ah, it's on this monitor. And we can't wait to get back to that, but until we can, someday we'll
keep bringing games to you so you can check them out via this magical digital medium that we have here. We put out the call
for there's no way to know
people from around the world sent in their games, and in fact this year was a record number of submissions, so Day of the Dez is bigger than ever, and the games are really 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 good, and we picked
we are generous
sponsors for their contribution.
Don't worry, close my eyes, I appreciate that. No, I don't think it was anything anything incriminating.
Talent and creativity on display just makes me really excited to be part of this industry, both to make games and to play them.
Yeah, no, good stuff. What a great way to open E3, even though it technically isn't opening E3 because E3 hasn't technically started yet. Oh, Sailor, thank you for the resub too. Yeah, it's I don't know. That was cool, I guess. Change your primary monitor. I don't think that's what affects it. It's the last monitor that Discord was on when you close it, right? I'm pretty sure that's what it is. Also, if I change my primary monitor, then all my games are going to run on something else. That's not... What? I want to hear about Axiom Verge 2. Do you use a program to manage multiple monitors? No. I guess what I wish is that if I mouse over it in the system tray, it would tell me which monitor it's going to pop up on. It's just, you know, these are streamer problems. There's a variety of weird multi-monitor issues that I've run into as a streamer that don't really affect anyone else. Well, cool. I'm 12 shots in, and I have a work day ahead of me, so that'll be fun. Let's see. What's coming up? I don't look at my calendar here. So that's kind of it for today. Tomorrow, Coke Media is doing a thing at noon, and then IGN is starting their expo at 1. I plan to be drinking through that. We'll see exactly what that amounts to. And then Saturday is the Gorilla Collective at 8 a.m. I'm going to do it. And then Ubisoft at noon, Devolver Digital at 1:30, and then Gearbox at 2. I'm definitely going to be watching Devolver's conference. One of the things I've loved about Devolver, apart from their curation of games, is that they use their E3 conferences to provide some pretty important commentary about games marketing. They did that last year, and I respected the absolute fuck out of it. Also, Devolver is—they like did what E3 talked about doing, but still didn't do this year, which is creating a digital space for people to go and play demos. They did the thing, that E3 is talking about, and no one seemed to care. Frustrating. Anyway, Devolver is really avant-garde when it comes to games marketing, in the extent that, like, in a Bo Burnham sort of way, they tell you out loud what they're doing while they're doing it. So I'm really looking forward to that. Also, they put out let's watch the prologue for Devolver's E3 conference.
It is a goddamn white-hot arms race out there. A hype-eats-hype, media-fueled intimidation game, a boss mode, knuckle-fuck-nut-kick. And we are falling way the mother-effing-ever shit behind. Melissa, do the numbers.
Yeah, so in the last...
It's bad, people. Real-type bad. We need a fresh perspective. Something wild. Something stunning. Something new, but not too new, but new enough so that it seems new to those know-it-all, know-nothings in the know, you know?
Actually, ma'am, I think...
No. No, no, no.
Record scratch. What? Who are you and why are you making noises at me?
Nina. Ma'am. Nina Struthers. I'm an adjunct under executive on the marketing team. I'm gunning for Synergy Office.
Adjunct under executive.
Because we need coffee.
Grab it, Hackjaw. Nina, is it? Put the coffee down and talk at my face.
Well, the thing of it is, a few of us were talking and...
Monetization. As a service.
Same.
What he said.
That's gotta be the most ridiculous.
Let's fucking do it.
A DMP. I can't wait to sign up for that. And give them $10 a month for whatever. Nina looks familiar. Yeah, Nina Struthers has been their like point character for all their conferences for like what, last 4 years? 5 years? Ever since they started developing a Devolver E3 conference continuity universe. Anyway, look, like the logo design is fucking on point. Also, so you want to talk about Y2K having rounded shits with gradients and especially shine, matte shine. That was the big thing Photoshop started to be able to do in like 2004. So like everybody had logos like this. So you want to talk about Y2K throwback? This right here, and like the plus, but it's italicized. I don't know. It's so good. And there's a TM. Of course, there's a TM. Anyway, the gradient abuse. Yeah, there's a lot of gradients. Mostly it's matte. It's like matte shininess because every logo is has that matte shiny. Anyway, yeah. No, expect a lot of tongue-in-cheek commentary about games as a service from that thing. I'm excited about that. So yeah, I'm looking forward to that. I'm gonna skip back and look at that Elden Ring trailer again. Let's look at that again. I guess what's weird for me now. What would really suck? And I think this might be where From Software is. They might be at this stage where they're too popular to make what they want anymore. So let's take a look at From Software's development list, because they're wild developers. So the Kingsfield series, Armored Core, Shadow Tower and Echo Knight. I actually didn't play those. Eternal Ring is like the game that everyone thought Elden Ring would be a spinoff of. And to some degree, they're not wrong, because it is a sort of Kingsfield kind of game. It's first-person dungeon exploration. Played it a little bit. But they've been all over the place. Adventures of Cookie and Cream. FromSoft game. Lost Kingdoms. FromSoft game. They used to be all over the map. Atogi 2. Kuon was a weird-ass game. Survival Horror. Metal Wolf Chaos is a pretty classic. People know it from the like intro. Never play Evergrace? No, that was like that was one of the launch, like that was a close to launch title on PS2, but back then I didn't have enough money to just buy whatever I wanted. Otherwise, I definitely would have. Ooh, Metacritic's not too hot on that one. This is before you had to give good scores to From Software games, and also before their games were largely great every time. Enchanted Arms was like a card collecting JRPG. Published by Ubisoft outside of weird stuff. So you like FromSoft, Chrome Hounds was a really weird one too. A very slow paced like mech combat simulator on the 360, no less. It kind of required communication, team comp, and tactics. You had to have like artillery mechs set up on a ridge so that you could send in your like attack mechs. And I don't know, this stuff is crazy. What bums me out is that From Software has this legacy of making like wildly different, incredibly original, and sometimes not very well executed games. But then Dark Souls came out, and since then, this is kind of what it is. It's like, look at this, Dark Souls, bang, 2012. I guess Demon's Souls technically was where it started, but Dark Souls 2012. And then it's like they have these scattered releases, but then it's like bam, 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 bam. Actually, Monster Hunter Diary is a bit of an outcast. I didn't know that was a FromSoft game. I might have to track that one down. And De Rossini, to me, was like the... that was a... Oh, shit. Like, old From Software is back. They're making some weird shit where... I think it's like you're a fairy in a boarding school. Received positive to mixed reviews from critics. Yeah, it's like, this is classic From Software. But it's like the only From Software game in the last 10 years that they've made that wasn't a Souls-like. If you consider Sekiro to be a Souls-like. So it might be that... They're kind of like stuck now, which is what worries me about the fact that this is the first shot in their trailer. They had to put in a hooded girl whispering to you about some arcane lore shit because that's a Souls staple. And I'm just like, man, I was hoping Elden Ring, and this is my personal artistic pretentious bullshit, as I hoped that Elden Ring was going to be a FromSoft like out of left field thing. It could have been. Doesn't seem like it's going to be. Not a problem. But that's what this trailer says to me, is like FromSoft might be locked in. They might be typecast in the way that Bruce Campbell was. They might be locked into making Souls-likes for the rest of their lives. No one else is going to greenlight anything unless it's an indie order is broken. De Rossini, like, I don't even know if I'm saying that. Like, it's just too many accents. So they show you summoning a horse. You can jump off of things and run around. There's a few different biomes. So yeah, all these shots kind of, to me, imply a like Hyrule Field sort of central. I'm going to guess this is, if I had to guess, is that there's going to be an open world and then there's going to be nodes that transfer you into a dungeon. It's going to be like straight up Zelda style. And then you have these, like, what gets me about this is that they didn't show any mechanics that would imply that you interact with this. All the mechanics they showed were like Dark Souls style combat. It's like lock on, circle strafe, dodge, roll, and stuff like this. There's no like Shadow of the Colossus style mantling, climbing, or Breath of the Wild style. So like, this might just be a world set piece. I didn't see the game express anything that implies that you run past this and that's it. Which is okay, but again, I'm looking for gameplay scenarios that are outside of the normal lock on, circle strafe around a monster and beat it until it's dead kind of thing. Which it doesn't need to have, but that's what I was kind of hoping for. What this implies to me, there's a carriage moving through what ostensibly is the open world. This is in the Hyrule Field scenario. So potentially in a Metal Gear Solid 5 kind of way, there will be these like caravans that move through the open world. And if you want to, you can try to raid them to get souls or whatever the currency of Elden Ring is, maybe a high tier loot drop or something like that. And the fact that it has these huge dudes pulling it, it's like, it's kind of a visual signifier. If you're looking out over the open world and you see this caravan, this sort of thing it's going to stick out visually. So you'll be able to actually like identify it and go for it if you want to. And then you'll have to fight guards. So it's not easy. But like a painting in a dark room with a man with armor and like a beast hide, and it's very gothic. It's just like, it's astoundingly Souls-like. And I guess I wasn't prepared for that. Maybe I should have been. Like, there's even some Gravelord Nito vibes. That's like a mixture of a centipede. And a skeleton man. I don't know. I guess I'm just confused why it's Elden Ring and not Dark Souls 4. Which it doesn't matter. Okay. Oh, I didn't notice that the first time. So the horse actually walks into a gameplay signifier. There are like boost points, which makes sense. If you're on a horse, everyone in Skyrim knows gaining elevation is a pain in the ass. So they have like actual nodes that fire you up in elevation. Makes sense. I would guess that you probably have to do a dungeon or two to unlock the ability to interact with these. So there will probably be other dungeons at the top of mountains or ledges that you can't get to yet. So they throw you into the open world after a tutorial. They teach you how to duck. They teach you how to circle strafe. They teach you how to dodge. And then they throw you into the open world. And even though it seems very open and free, passability gates make it so you can only go to one dungeon. That first dungeon gives you the horse jump or whatever. And then that unlocks more of the world. Kind of in the way the Breath of the Wild threw you into the open world and you had to get the glider first before you could actually go to the rest of the game. Yeah, the combat they showed made it look super Souls-like. There's nothing. So the only thing about the combat that looked interesting is this. Maybe not the only thing. That's a bit strong. But what this is like, this is cool. So it's a hit and then into like a charge move. So that implies to me like combos that can go into different player abilities. So maybe if you're a caster, you bop them with your staff, you hop back, and then you charge up a spell and throw it. Something like that. And that's the thing that can only work if you have the clearance and there's no enemies around. And that could play really well with like open world mechanics. So this shot is like this player engaging with Breath of the Wild terminology. Let's say they're like jumping a group of moblins here. And they wouldn't be able to do a move like this, where they hop back and charge up an attack, if there were more enemies around. So maybe that's something where it's like, you have to account for the open world, you have to account for the distribution of enemies when you're using your combos and stuff like that. This is interesting, though. The shot of the person, like, camping at a fire. This kind of implies that there's going to be a rest or a camping mechanic, because they're in the open world, because you can still see the tree. The tree seems to be the giant set piece of the open world, and is probably like a north star for navigating. Because navigation through 3D spaces can be tough for players. So if you give them a giant, like, spike to be a place where they can coordinate their perspective, it makes a lot of sense to sort of navigate the open world. So if you're in the open world and you're lost, you see this giant tree in the distance, you're like, oh, that's north. So I know I have to go to the right of the tree to get to the next dungeon or something like that. And yeah, Yggdrasil references for sure. It's the world tree and stuff like that. I mean, it wouldn't be the first time the Japanese games just like buffet style sample every world religion to piece their world together. Also, there's a giant moon here. That's neat. A lot of particle effects because it's this gen. And when you're developing a cross-generation game, you can't go too ham on fundamental rendering mechanics. So you just shove in as many particle effects as you can. I do love that transition where it's like, it's an old game, but it's got so many particles in it now. I think they did say it was last gen. Am I wrong about that? I might be wrong about that. But I'm presuming it's cross-gen. It's going to be like 4 years until we get exclusively new gen games. So that's interesting. That little shine there, I assume that's like an item use. Twing! So that's the animation, right? You pull it out of the trans-dimensional pocket, you hold it up, and then you pop it. So we got an Elden Ring man here using a cube item for something. Summon cube? Yeah, maybe. Oh, that's the summoning item? Yeah, if it goes from here into... Oh, yeah, look at that. It absolutely is a summoning item. So, yeah, then you have friendly spirits coming in to help you out. Makes total sense. Although, this is a nightman. In Souls games, fighting another human player in armor... not like human as in there's a human controlling it, but even in universe, like a humanoid figure that is not completely warped or distorted by Souls energy... is usually a pretty big deal. So maybe this is like a mini boss or something that you have to summon some souls to help you out with. Again, same old soul shit. Which is not a knock, because boy do I love Souls games. That's alright. The lightning coming down is kind of interesting. Got horse leaps. Maybe they're implying that like horse summoning is going to be a boss mechanic, where I guess if they give you more mobility options, they can be a little looser about the scale of the attacks they throw at you. So if you're just a man on your feet, you can't really dodge like a 60-yard wide lightning strike, right? But if you're on a horse, then you can. So I'm gonna guess there are bosses where part of their attack phases is you have to summon your horse and use your horse to dodge their attacks for a while, and then they mellow out and you can and then you can do it. I feel like this is like key art. This is key art stuff. Like red hair flowing out of a gold like, and the wings on it kind of strike me. I get Hermes vibes whenever I see something with wings on it. Again, this mishmash of world lores and world cultures. Girl from the teaser, yeah. This is like cover art stuff. She looks very Valkyrie. Yes, she does. And Valkyries are, they operate in the world of the dead, or that like purgatory between life and death, and that's the exact stripe where a lot of From Software Souls games tend to exist, that like weird middle ghostly ground between being alive and dead. To be born. This is a sick move. Well, I guess this implies that she's a boss character or a villain, but it's a grab attack pretty clearly. I've been fucked by this exact move multiple times to not see it. Like, this is something that's going to take 80% of your life bar. Forever Joe, thank you for the sub, by the way. Missed that a while ago. Well, a lowly tarnished. Tarnished. So we are no longer what? There's like hollowed, forsaken, and now we are tarnished. Gosh, you just jumble up the words like Mad Lib sometimes. The Ashen One, yeah. A lot of gold accents. It's very, like, kind of like the Soul series. It's super muted. It's super desaturated. But a lot of gold, which is interesting. To me, gold is opulence. And when you mix gold with decay, it creates, again, it's that Soul's shit of, like, there was a golden era, but it passed. And now we're in the, like, decay. And the gold still persists, but the decay is here, too. So it's that mix of, like, there was a golden era, and now it's fallen. Yeah. Again, just, like, Crazy Souls vibes. And then, like, gosh, the sizzle of all the monster design they have is so good. This dude with, like, the fire popping out of his head. You know, bit of Ornstein and Smo vibes, because he's like a chrome man who's kind of fat. But I like the idea of a boss that just spews out AoE from their head all the time. Fire Smo, yeah. It's frustrating because I'm sure the last thing that anyone who works on this game wants is to be relentlessly compared to other Souls games. But that's, I mean, come on. Did you notice that enemy that was a pot with arms? Yeah, it felt like a new mimic, kind of. I imagine you smash pots to get items in this game, and then eventually a pot will get up and try to eat you or run away or something like that. The scale of the bosses they show are pretty impressive, and I think they can do that because of the horse. I think the horse lets you run away, and I'm going to guess when you get on the horse, your FOV widens out, because that way they can widen the camera to show you these giant bosses. It is like Shadow of the Colossus vibes, I think. That's in Orlando. Yeah, right? It's like, it's the only pristine Victorian structure in this entire game. And like, you can see the rot in the foreground too. So it's like, and then there's these little like magic wispies. So it's like, oh, this place looks really clean, but it's probably just because of the magic. It's just like, there's so much that's, again, why isn't this called Dark Souls 4? When I play it, maybe it'll click. But also, so they went from Demon Souls to Dark Souls because Demon Souls was owned by Sony. That was my presumption. But Dark Souls was owned by FromSoft, I thought. So I don't know why they would leap franchises again. You're getting really hung up on the title. Not on a creative standpoint. I'm thinking about it from a marketing and business standpoint. There's no reason to not call something established franchise plus number, because you've already established a cachet for that franchise. So they are willingly walking away from sales by not calling it Dark Souls 4. That's it for me. And there has to be a reason they did that. And I don't know what that reason is. That's it. That's the riddle for me. TLDR, Miyazaki did not want to do another Souls. That could also be it. It could be that simple. Or because George R. R. Martin didn't want to work on an existing franchise. Also that. It could be that. It could be all of this. Those are all very viable explanations. I just don't know. That's it. I'm not upset by it or anything like that. I'm trying to solve the business mystery of it. That's it. There's a lot of cachet in putting an iterative number on an established brand. Miyazaki didn't want to do another Souls. That's really the answer. He's burnt out on it. Okay, well, he made another Souls, so whoops. But that's fine, man. Sometimes that's all it takes. Actually, hold on. Let me. Like, this guy's face looked pretty cool. Look at that. They're like wearing academia masks. Now that, man, you could read a lot into that. It's like Greek sculpture masks of philosophers. Like they're pretending to be philosophers or something like that. Or they've created a cult around big thinkers. I like that. I like that a lot. He's got a little staff. He's got a little crystal poking out. We get some magic. So character builds confirmed. You can be a magic user. You can be a sword user. I'm wondering if it's like, surely it's not just like character class. Like, you start the game and it's like, do you want to be an archer, a fighter, or a wizard? Could be, but I doubt it. Because people really do love putting numbers into stats, as meaningless as it may be. People love it. Now, this is rad. This reminds me of, what is it, the, like, the Thunder boss from Souls 3. The guy who would get on a fucking dragon and fly around. Gonna play through this on stream and educate us on the lore and read every piece of text on screen on every item or not? I don't know. For Souls games, that might be a little beyond my scope, but Nameless King, that was it, yeah. Big Nameless King vibes, except it's blue instead of yellow. A lot of, like... So it's interesting, the color grading of this game. It makes sense that a lot of the environment and a lot of the effects are blue, because gold is yellow, and that's your color wheel. You get blue and yellow, or blue and orange. Guy in a mask here. Huh. This reminds me of the, like, the Man in the Iron Mask. Leprosy kind of stuff. Decay. I like... So I caught that shot briefly. The light, there's like a spider with like fingers. There it is. Yes! Now this is a rad enemy design. And who knows what the hell it is, but 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Like, it's got more than a hand's worth of like... And all the fingernails are like all... They're all like pointed and creepy and black. Man. And there's like a segmented part on this one. I mean, that's probably the like shoot at me. Looks like it has some rings around the middle finger. Yeah, yeah. That's the please hit this player iconography there. So this was an interesting scene. This like hand clutching a naked player. I can only guess that this is from the prologue, where your like created player doesn't have gear or anything yet. I'm gonna guess that this scene happens after, again, the Souls prologue, where you play and then you die, and then it's like, okay, now the game has started. And I'm gonna guess that this shot is from that sequence. What's weird is they have like fingerprint. They have fingerprint etching all over the hand. So it's not just on the fingers, it's everywhere. There's like fingerprints all over the place, which is interestingly grotesque. I was really fascinated by that shot. And then, yeah, more Valkyrie imagery, I guess. An Einherjar. Like, you even see the angel wings, and it's like somebody in full armor with a sword and a shield. And another boss fight. But the boss fights don't seem to be in the open world. They seem to be in contained environments, which again is probably like you'll be in Hyrule Field with the giant Yggdrasil somewhere to be your North Star. And then you find these nodes that transition you into dungeons that have a series of hallways and rooms with treasure, culminating in a boss fight with the collector from Mortal Kombat. Well, no, that's a boss fight with a tree in the background. Never mind. I take it back. Take it back entirely. What's really cool is they're establishing some like principal visuals. The lady with the gold armor and the wings and the red hair, and then the tree. And those two things are probably going to be on the cover art, because those are very powerful images. Also, again, the gold accents and the blue. Solid visual design. And the mutant, like, legion hand with tons of people baked into it. Now that I see it again, I'm kind of reading more into this idea that these warriors are combinations of many slain warriors or something like that. Getting more Valkyrie vibes, getting more, like, death is not the end of your combat kind of thing. And again, like, medieval style parapets and stuff like that. The tree inlaid here. There's some Greek worked into this, it seems like. Quite a bit of Greek worked into this, which is fashionable. I'm going to throw this out because I'm 12 shots in. It seems like Greek is the way you make things white nowadays. You can't just have, like, things be schlubby and white. But Greek, that's fine. Assassin's Creed Valhalla, totally fine. Every schlubby white dude likes to believe that there are some kind of Nordic berserker under the skin, even if they're sitting in, you know, they're like me carrying around 50 pounds of body fat. Anyway, sir, thank you for the Thank you for the cheer. That just seems to be my read. You got to harken back a little bit. And then even then, the concentric circles in the... it's called Elden Ring. So ring, like the idea of a circle ought to be important iconography. But this also seems very Celtic, very Nordic. And the fact that it, like, the only non-circular shape is coming off, it's like dripping off of this sun idea. And again, blue and yellow. I mean, that's been a mainstay of logo and icon design for a while. But is this reading in too much or not enough? That's the fun part. That's the fun part. Artistic analysis just exists in the ether. And no one can be wrong. That's what I love about analyzing shit, is you can't be wrong because you're just spitting ideas. Yeah, this is really interesting. This logo here. So it's, let's see here. How many rings are there? 1, 2, 3, 4. Am I wrong about that? No, it's 4. 4 and then one thing piercing them all. So maybe 4 world bosses. Which? Breath of the Wild? Interesting stuff. Like this half circle at the top. This logo does imply a lot of like... I mean, circles... again, this is full into fluff territory here, but... Circle of life, life and death into life again. But then you have a line cutting it in half. So life into death, bang, it's been bisected. Now you're stuck or like trapped in this ethereal realm between life and death. And again, going back to the Nordic stuff of when you die, a noble warrior gets scouted by a Valkyrie and resurrected as an Einherjar to fight again. That fits so much in line with where FromSoft has been for a long time, where all their games exist in this fugue state between life and death. And even you as a player kind of exist in this ghostly dimension where you are interacting with other players who have also died. You know, you see their signs on the ground and you see their moments to death. And then you're just kind of, you know, you're in that sort of like, you're not living and you're not dead. You're kind of trapped in the middle. And that's, you know, the middle of the Venn diagram. Or the quad Venn diagram. It makes sense, but it's also so in line with the Souls series that, again, I have to wonder, why wasn't it called Dark Souls 4? And again, maybe it was just Miyazaki insisted that it wasn't a thing. Yeah, PC Digital instead of a Steam code. Interesting. Maybe Epic Games is out there cutting some deals. Who knows? Maybe they haven't obligated yet. I'm kind of okay with PC not just being Steam, because I've had my annoyances with Steam for a long time. But just a theory. If the lore is different, it couldn't really be Dark Souls 4. Yeah, Hazari, that's a good point. I won't say that I'm like studied up on the lore of Dark Souls enough to understand why there could or couldn't be a Souls after 3. Typically, you resolve things with a trilogy. So maybe this is just them starting a new Souls trilogy. Maybe it's just that simple. And I will say that, like, it occurs to me as an anecdotal observation, the Japanese developers seem to be less concerned about marketability in general. If they feel like doing a thing, they'll do it, which is great. It doesn't seem... Western devs are typically... They bend what they do to marketing reasons all the time. So even if a game shouldn't be Dark Souls 4, they would make it Dark Souls 4. Whereas a Japanese dev, even if a game should be Dark Souls 4, they'll choose not to just because they don't want it to be that way. Miyazaki likes to create independent yet similar stories. No sequels. Dark Souls 3 existed to amend Dark Souls 2. Could be. If it's on Epic, I'll just wait the year and grab it cheap on Steam. Got tons to keep me occupied. Yeah, I mean, that's true of any video game. There are so many games out there. It's tough to it's tough to get particularly worked up over any of them. Scruffy Fern, thank you for the sub. Thank you very much. I doubt it'll be Epic exclusive. No, I doubt it too. Well, maybe. Money talks, and Epic's got a lot to throw around. I'm not speculating that the game would be Epic exclusive or anything like that. But I do think that the fact that this doesn't say Steam means that there are interested parties who are talking about it. And I think that's important. I think that's pretty cool. I'm glad that the PC platform, at least, has become a place of contention where developers can at least haggle a little bit, get a little more money out of it. So, yeah, I'm all right with it. GOG exclusive. Maybe. Maybe, hey, if it's GOG exclusive, that means through my association, I get a free code. So I'm all right with that. But you know what? I can pay for games too. Speaking of paying for things, I had to do one more plug before I wrap it up. So I did ask for a 30% off code for this weekend because it's E3 and I'm going to get blasted. And I'm going to use G Fuel to keep me alive through it, their hydration mix. So I do have a 30% off code for G Fuel. If you're into that, if you have any questions about it, I'll be happy to answer them for you. I'm glad that I always want my sponsor plugs to be equally entertaining as well as I thought you were going to sponsor Monster. Well, so it's interesting you bring that up. It's interesting you bring that up, Kinatar. You might find some creative intent behind the design of that plug, because yes, you're right, it is the three claws. But then a rocket blows it up, and out of that big bang of energy comes a 30% discount for G Fuel. So when is G Milk happening? I mean, I could maybe this weekend. You guys buy enough G Fuel, and I'll take a G Milk shooter with Bruce. Oh yeah, okay. So let me plug the rest of my E3 plans, because we're kind of winding down for today. That was kind of all we had for today. So tomorrow is Coke Media at noon, IGN at 1 p.m. I'll be doing those, but again, Friday's a pretty light day. Saturday's when that shit kicks off. I'll be up at 8 a.m. for some goddamn reason doing the Gorilla Collective. Again, same rules. I might tweak them a bit. But Saturday at 8 a.m. Pacific, Gorilla Collective, Ubisoft at noon, Devolver Digital at 1:30. I'm very excited for that. And then after that, whenever that wraps up, I'll probably go back and watch Gearbox's presentation, which will probably have a lot of Tiny Tina in it. And I will try my best to get through that diplomatically. Sunday, the Xbox and Bethesda showcase at 10 a.m. Square Enix at noon, Back for Blood showcase at 2 p.m. PC Gaming Show at 2:30. Future Game Show at 4 p.m. And then Monday and Tuesday, because Bruce is obligated. He's a professional host. He's making those professional checks, which good for him. But his obligations wrap up on Sunday. So Monday and Tuesday, Bruce and I are going to be pounding some drinks to the Take-Two Interactive conference at 10 a.m. Freedom Games presentation at 12:30. This is on Monday, June 14th. Capcom at 2:30. I'm hoping to see more Pragmata. Maybe Dragon's Dogma 2, but we'll see. And then Tuesday, the big shit. Nintendo at 9 a.m. I'm gonna get in a rideshare and go to Bruce's place so that I can be there at 9 a.m. and take shots while Nintendo talks about God willing, Ring Fit Adventure 2. Let me tell you guys, the thing that I have waited in the whole year for is for me to take shots and scream at the top of my lungs at Ring Fit Adventure 2 while Bruce just sits there confused, annoyed, and bored. That's what I'm excited for. So we'll see. This coming Tuesday, that'll probably be on both my and his channels. So that's at 9 a.m. on Tuesday. And then Bandai Namco is at 2:30 that day, p.m. Pacific. And we might get a more intense look at... Oh, I know this game. Oh, we might get a more intense look at this is No Straight Roads? No, this is something else. I played this. God, what is this called? This is a good game and I like it a lot. So that's the plan for E3. That probably doesn't make a lot of sense. If you want to, I have a schedule. It's shortened bit.ly/lawstream, L-A-W stream. So there you can see the my stream schedule. If you want to check out the more drunk E3 things going on. But man, I love this. This is so nourishing to me. This is, I wait all year for a couple of things. One is Awesome Games Done Quick. Two is E3. You should make a command for that. Well, I have. Kestru. Excuse me. If you type schedule, which is a tough word to spell out. Schedule. There's a link to it in chat. I just posted it there. So, thank you guys very much for watching. I have some other work to do. Producing Inside Games with Bruce again. Again, if you remember Inside Gaming, we're doing it again. We're doing it again. It's just the Inside Games channel, which I will also link in chat right now. But we're going to be covering Battlefield 2042. Bruce is a huge Battlefield fan, so I'm really excited for this. I love any episode of Inside Games we get to do where Bruce is like bought into everything, because mostly it's just me kind of nerding out and him being a good sport. But this one, he gets to nerd out, so I'm excited for that. So we got to write the script for that, and we're going to record that later. We'll see how sober I am. Might be a good episode, but all right. Thank you guys very much for watching. I'll be back tomorrow with some other E3 conferences. Do you know anything about the rumors of Battlefield actually having destruction? Do you mean like a levolution? Is that what you're referring to? I mean, there was like the tornado in the trailer, but that's about it, as far as I know. Anyway, all right. Thank you guys very much for watching. I'll be back tomorrow with more drinking in E3, an insightful commentary, and through the rest of the weekend. Oh, I can't tell you guys how excited I am. Oh, this is so great. This is so great. I'm exactly in my element right now. All right. Raid Bruce. Wait, is Bruce live right now? I'll raid Bruce. Bruce is live right now. Oh, he's playing Chivalry. No shit. All right. I would join him, but I got some work to do. So, yeah, we'll raid Bruce. We'll raid Bruce. You guys be nice to Bruce. Of course you would be. All right. Thank you guys very much. Have a great rest of the weekend. Enjoy E3. Enjoy some video games, and I'll see you guys tomorrow. Right, bye, everybody.
Introducing on...